guess it was a song they wrote saying don't go slow, cause you're gonna be someone. They were singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I heard it on the radio on my way back home. Some days I don't think my mama thinks I'm good enough to be a superstar. But one day I will show her I'm a diamond in the rough and be a superstar. Cause there's a crown covered in glitter and gold. I'm gonna wear it, whether you like it or not. Yeah, there's a crown covered in glitter and gold. I'm gonna wear it, whether you like it or not. And I'll be singing hallelujah, 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 whether you like it or not. Yeah, I'll be singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. There's a crown covered in glitter and gold. I'm gonna wear it, whether you like it or not. Yeah, there's a crown covered in glitter and gold. I'm gonna wear it, whether you like it or not. And I'll be singing hallelujah, 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 whether you like it or not. Yeah, I'll be singing hallelujah, 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 whether you like it or not. I heard it on the radio on my way back home that I'm gonna be someone. I guess it was a song they wrote saying don't go slow, cause you're gonna be someone. They were singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Today's a good day, never know when the next one will show, it'll show. So I'ma sing my soul, I'ma sing my soul. Today's a good day, never know, never know when the next one will show, it'll show. So I'ma sing my soul.
Good evening, everybody. We are going to get started. Thank you. Yeah, guys, thank you so much for being here. Tonight we have the great privilege of hearing from Dr. Frank Turek. Dr. Turek travels the country speaking at secular universities, and he's written a number of books which are on sale in the back of the room if you haven't already seen that stuff back there. Tonight he's going to be talking about why he does not have enough faith to be an atheist, and at the end there's going to be plenty of time for questions. So I encourage you guys to think of good questions to ask and come up when that time is initiated. There's also QR codes that are going to be, they're all over the room, taped on the back of chairs. It's going to be displayed on the screen later. And the purpose of that is just if you want to get connected, if you're not part of a church or campus ministry, and that's something that you're interested in getting connected with, or if you just have questions about the talk tonight, feel free to scan that code. It's a really short survey, and we'd love to connect with you, answer any questions that you have. A number of different churches and campus ministries in the UC Cincinnati area have come together to put this event on tonight, and on behalf of all of them, we just want to welcome Dr. Frank Turek.
Good evening, Bearcats. Let's go back to September 29th, 2006. That's when Petty Officer Michael Mansour is a United States Navy SEAL operating in Ramadi, Iraq. Mansour is standing on a roof in Ramadi, and he's standing in front of a doorway to this roof. He has two Navy SEAL teammates lying in the sniper-prone position next to him. They've already taken AK-47 fire and a rocket-propelled grenade, but they're not exactly sure where the enemy is. There's a bit of a lull in the fighting. Insurgents have blocked off the streets in Ramadi, and there's someone on the loudspeaker in the town mosque yelling, "Kill the Americans!" As Mansour and his team are looking for the next attack, an insurgent from an unknown location throws a grenade up on the roof. It hits Mansour in the chest, and it falls to his feet. Due to the length of the throw, there's no opportunity to pick it up and throw it back. He has only a split second to make a decision. He can leap through the doorway behind him and save himself, but if he does, his two teammates lying on the roof will surely die. Mansour yells, "Grenade!" But instead of jumping backward to save himself, he jumps forward, chest first, onto the grenade. It detonates. 30 minutes later, 25-year-old Michael Mansour is dead. His two teammates lying on the roof receive only minor injuries because Mansour's body muffled the blast. One of the survivors said at Mansour's funeral, "Mikey looked death in the face that day and said, 'You will not take my friends, I will go in their stead.'" I've never seen a United States president cry until April of 2008. That's when President George W. Bush invited Mansour's parents into the East Room of the White House to give them their son's Medal of Honor posthumously. The president couldn't even get through the citation without breaking down. Since then, Mansour's high school in Garden Grove, California, built a new stadium. They named it Michael A. Mansour Memorial Stadium. The golden trident insignia that the SEALs wear. USS Michael Mansour, the newest guided missile destroyer in the fleet. Zumwalt class. This is Mansour's mother, Sally, being escorted onto the ship, named in honor of her fallen son. Now, why did they do this? Because Michael Mansour literally sacrificed himself to save his friends. There's no greater love than to sacrifice yourself to save your friends, said Jesus of Nazareth before he went to the cross. Michael Mansour sacrificed himself to save his friends. The question is, would anyone sacrifice himself to save you? And the answer is, someone already has. His name is Jesus of Nazareth. But in today's culture, a lot of people don't think the story's true. After all, it was written down by religious people. We know religious people tend to embellish things. It also has miracles in it. We don't believe in miracles anymore. How can we believe such a story's true? Well, I actually think it's quite easy to show that it's true. You only need to answer four questions in the affirmative to show that Christianity's true. In other words, if you investigate these four questions, I think you'll realize that the answer to these four questions is yes. And if the answer to these four questions is yes, then Christianity's true. What are the four questions? Here are the four questions. Is some pretty grooving music, isn't it? Yes. That is actually from our TV show on Wednesday nights on DirecTV Channel 378. It's also on Roku. Look for NRB TV on Roku. We're also on radio every Saturday mornings at 10 a.m., but I know if you're a college student, you don't get up till the crack of noon on Saturday, so you're not listening to it then. That's okay. It's podcasted. It's called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. And what we do is we present evidence for Christianity and we cross-examine ideas against it. That's our website right there, crossexamine.org. Now, why are these the four questions? Truth, God, miracles, and the New Testament. And this is going to serve as our outline here tonight. First question, does truth exist? Why is that important? Because you hear people saying there's no truth. You got your truth, I got my truth, right? Well, if there's no truth, obviously Christianity can't be true. Of course, if there's no truth, then atheism can't be true either, right? In fact, if there's no truth, why would you be at the University of Cincinnati? What are you here to learn? Opinions? No, you're here to learn truth, right? We're going to deal with that question first. Second question, does God exist? Obviously, Christianity can't be true if there's no God. But I hope to show you tonight that there are three arguments that can show us that a theistic God exists. These arguments are taught in the Bible, but you don't need the Bible to know them. In fact, we're not even going to refer to the Bible when we talk about question number two. You don't need the Bible or any other religious writing to figure out that God exists. Third question, are miracles possible? Obviously, if Christianity has a resurrection, there's got to be miracles. The miracles have to be possible. And a lot of people don't believe they're possible, but I hope to show you tonight that not only are miracles possible, but the greatest miracle in the Bible has already occurred, and even atheists are admitting the data for this miracle. Then we're going to get to the key question, is the New Testament true? The New Testament doesn't have a prayer if there's no truth, no God, or no miracles. But if truth exists, if God exists, and miracles are possible, then we want to see if the documents are reliable enough to let us know if one event from the ancient world took place, and that would be the resurrection. Because if Jesus rose from the dead, game over, Christianity's true. Of course, if he didn't rise from the dead, game over. You might as well sleep in on Sunday and watch or do whatever you want the rest of the week because Christianity's not true. Even their greatest apostle Paul said, look, if Jesus hasn't risen from the dead, your faith's in vain. Everything hinges on that event. Did it happen or didn't it? Now, we can't go through this in great detail tonight. If you want to go further, the book's available on the book table as well as a 12-part DVD series. There's a newer book out there called Stealing from God, Why Atheists Need God to Make Their Case. What that book is about, I've noticed that sometimes when atheists are arguing there is no God, they actually have to steal aspects of reality that would only exist if God existed in order to say he doesn't exist. In effect, they have to sit in God's lap to slap his face. Now, you don't have to buy any of these books. But if you do, I do want to point out that all the proceeds from the sale of the books and the DVDs will go to feed needy children. Mine. Okay? Just so you know. All right? Actually, you don't need to buy a book if you want this PowerPoint presentation because I'm going to send it to you for free if you just type the word evidence to 44222. Don't put quotes on evidence, just the word evidence. To 44222, I'm going to send you this entire PowerPoint presentation in a PDF format. Even the slides I can't show you because we have limited time here tonight. All right, I'll put that up at the end as well. What we're going to do, though, is we're going to start right here at point one. Does truth exist? Are you ready to go? Yeah. Bearcats, come on, let's go. Yeah. You're ready to go. All right, whenever you start talking about truth, you always have to start with Jack Nicholson. Right? Because Tom Cruise had him on the witness stand, and he said to him, "Colonel, I want the truth." And Nicholson said, "You guys are number two in college football." With that sissy response? I mean, please, he didn't say it that way. "You can't handle the truth." He said it this way.
"I want the truth. You can't handle the truth."
All right, let's try it again.
"I want the truth.
You can't handle the truth."
Now, that felt better, didn't it? You can go to the playoffs with a response like that. That was pretty good. Well, there's a lot of people that can't handle the truth. They're saying, "You got your truth, I got my truth, all truth is relative." Well, if you don't get anything outside of what we talk about here tonight, this is going to be the most important thinking skill we're going to talk about. Whether you're a Christian, an atheist, or anywhere in between, this is going to be helpful. This thinking skill is so powerful that half of what you need to know to discover what really is true, you'll know after you learn this thinking skill. And it's easy. But I was a dimwit. I was 33 years old. I already had a master's degree, and I didn't even know what I'm about to show you right now. And it's so simple. And the easiest way of showing you this thinking skill is to demonstrate using it. Suppose someone were to come up to you and say, "There is no truth," postmodern claim. What would you say to somebody who said that? Yeah, is that true? Is it true that there's no truth? Because if it's true that there's no truth, the claim there is no truth can't be true, but it claims to be true. Did I say that right? Can everybody see that this is a self-defeating statement? A self-defeating statement doesn't meet its own standard. A self-defeating statement violates the law of non-contradiction. A self-defeating statement is like saying, "I can't speak a word in English." If I were to say that, what would you say? Man, you just use English to say it. You're doing exactly what you say can't be done. It can't be true. Now, here's the thinking skill. What you want to do when somebody says something like this is you want to turn the claim on itself. Turn the claim on itself. So if somebody says there is no truth, you turn that claim on itself and you say, "Is that true?" Right? Now, let's do a few more of these because there are many in our culture. Suppose someone says all truth is relative. They may say it that way rather than there's no truth. If someone were to say this to you, if you turn the claim on itself, what would you say back? Yes, is that a relative truth? No, this is an absolute truth claim claiming that all truths are relative. That's obviously self-defeating. It's like saying I can't speak a word in English, or it's like saying my parents had no kids that lived, right? Or my brother is an only child. These are self-defeating statements. And once you get good at recognizing these, it's going to save you a lot of pain and suffering. Why? Because this process of turning a claim on itself will help you discover what is false, and half the battle is trying to avoid what is false. If you start living by false principles, eventually you're going to slap up against reality, and it's going to hurt. You want to spend your time looking at truth. How about this? Sometimes it's not said there is no truth or all truth is relative. It's probably said in our culture more often than not this way. There isn't the truth, there's only my truth. You've probably heard that or something like it. I get to live my truth, right? If someone were to say this to you and you were to turn the claim on itself, what would you say back? You say, is that just your truth or is it the truth? Because if this is just your truth up here, then it's just your opinion. So why should I believe it? But if it's the truth, then it can't be true because you're saying there is no the truth. It's self-defeat. You know what the truth of the matter is? I know this might be upsetting to some, but there's no such thing as your truth. There's just the truth. I know nobody likes to hear that, but that's just the way things are. Sorry. There's not your math. There's just the math. Right? There's not your logic. There's just the logic. Now, sometimes it isn't said this way either. Sometimes it's said this way. Well, it's true for you, but not for me. This is my favorite one, actually. If somebody says it's true for you, but not for me, what would you say back to them? If you turn the claim on itself, what would you say back? Yeah, there you go. You'd say, is that true for everybody? It's true for you, but not for me. True for everybody? Because if true for you, but not for me, is true for everybody, then true for you, but not for me, can't be true because it's true for everybody. Did I say that right? I know that can give you intellectual constipation if you think about it long enough. But that's because it's self-defeating. It's like saying, I can't speak a word in English. Actually, there's a more fun way of dealing with this. If somebody says it's true for you but not for me, say, sure, go try that with your bank teller. Yeah, go to your bank teller and say, you know, I'd like $100,000 out of my account. The bank teller looks at your account and says, I'm sorry, I only have $6.04 in your account. It's easy to get the money. You simply say, ha, that's true for you but not for me. Give me the 100 grand. Are you going to get the money? No, if it's true there was only $6.04 in your account, that's true for all people at all times in all places when referring to your account at that time. It's just true. And I'm surprised, but a lot of Christians don't seem to get this. I go to a lot of churches. I ask them, do you think Christianity is true? And they say, why? And then I ask them why, and they say, because I have faith. Is that a good answer? Does your faith make something true? Does your faith change whether or not God exists or Jesus rose from the dead? Do you have to believe something to make it true? Do you have to believe in gravity to stay on the ground? Do people who don't believe in gravity float away? Hey, look, there's another one. Hey, if you believe, you'll come back. No, that's not the way it works. You say, well, why is the Bible always talking about faith then? Because there's two kinds of faith. There's belief that, and then there's belief in. Belief that is getting evidence that God exists, that Jesus rose from the dead. We call this apologetics, giving evidence for what you believe. It's not apologizing. You're trying to give evidence for what you believe. But all the belief that in the world won't get your moral transgressions forgiven. For that, you got to go from belief that to belief in. You see, James, the half-brother of Jesus, who wrote that little book in the New Testament called, you guys are sharp tonight. He said, even the demons believe that God exists, but they tremble. Do you realize that demons know that God exists better than we do? But they don't trust in him. If you want to have your moral transgressions forgiven, you have to go from belief that to belief in, to trust in. Look, we know this distinction in relationships, don't we? There's a difference between belief that and belief in. When I first met my wife 36 years ago, I got evidence that she would be a good wife. But all the evidence in the world didn't make her my wife. I had to take a step of trust in her to ask her to be my wife. And in a momentary lapse of judgment, she said yes. That's the difference between belief that and belief in. Really, the word we ought to use is trust. Trust in. That's really what the Bible's talking about when it talks about faith. Most of the time, it's talking about the second kind. Trust in. After you know that it's true, trust in it. The real definition is trusting in what you have good reason to believe is true. That's the definition of faith. Trusting in what you have good reason to believe is true. How about this? You've probably heard this claim. There's no truth in anything but science. If you turn the claim on itself, what would you say back to somebody who said that? Is that a scientific truth? Can you go in the laboratory and prove that? No, that's a philosophical claim. You can't prove that in the laboratory. That's philosophy, and you can't do science without philosophy. It's built on philosophy. In fact, everything's built on philosophy. Reading the Bible's built on philosophy. Everything's built. Chemistry's built on physics is built on philosophy. In fact, there's in the book back there, Stealing from God, there's a chapter on science. Here's the title of the chapter. Science doesn't say anything. Scientists do. Say, why is that? Because all data needs to be gathered, and all data needs to be interpreted. And who does that? Scientists. You ever wonder why you're getting conflicting advice on COVID? Because sometimes scientists have the same data, but they're interpreting it differently. Sometimes they have different data, so they come to different conclusions. Sometimes they have inadequate data, but they still try and draw conclusions. Sometimes there's a political agenda. No, that'll never happen. Science doesn't say a word. Scientists say things. And sometimes your philosophical presuppositions can cause you to interpret the data differently than someone else. And if you think about it, the most important things in life have nothing to do with science. Honey, do you love me? Yeah. How come? I don't know. Let's run an experiment. No! You've probably heard this too. You should doubt everything. Skeptical claim. Someone says this, and you apply the claim to itself, you turn the claim on itself, what are you going to say back? Yeah, should I doubt that? Why are skeptics skeptical of everything but skepticism? You ever notice they don't doubt that? Now look, how many people in here, regardless of whether you're Christian, atheist, anywhere in between, how many people in here sometimes doubt that what you believe about those things is true? Look, if you don't have your hand up right now, you're probably not thinking very much, right? I mean, I've written books on this stuff, and sometimes I wake up in the morning, I go, I don't even know if this is true. But then I start thinking about my doubts, and I realize most of my doubts are emotional. They're not intellectual. In other words, the evidence for Christianity is really good. If I'm having a good day, everything's fine. Bad day, don't know. Good day, fine. Bad day, don't know. Good day, fine. Bad day, don't know. What's changing, me or the evidence? Me, I'm going up and down. You know what the truth of the matter is? Your psychology is not going to tell you the truth about Christianity or anything. It's not. The evidence will. You know, a lot of people are really afraid to fly. They're afraid to get on a plane. Psychologically, they can't handle it. But do you know, statistically, it's the safest way to get anywhere? But they can't handle it. They won't go on. They're afraid. The psychology is not telling them the truth. The evidence will tell them the truth. Same thing is true in Christianity or anything else. In fact, sometimes when an atheist will see me at an event like this, they'll say, Frank, you know, I used to be a Christian, but I'm an atheist now. I lost my faith. Now, I don't mean to be unkind, but since I'm from New Jersey, sometimes I am. And when they say that, I almost want to say, so? So are you telling me because your psychology changed that God has somehow popped out of existence? Are you telling me that your psychology changed, that Jesus didn't rise from the dead? Again, your psychology is not the test for truth. The evidence is. So if you really start thinking about the evidence, then I think you'll realize that your doubts aren't really all that impressive. In fact, if you start doubting your doubts, then you're back to knowing something for sure. Have you guys ever thought about doubting your doubts? I doubt it. Or how about this? You ought not judge. If somebody says you ought not judge, what are you going to say back? Hey, isn't that a judgment? You ever notice that's a judgment? You say, wait a minute, Frank, didn't Jesus say don't judge? Nope, never said it. He did. He said it in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. All right, I know this is going to sound a little weird, but it's true. There are no verses in the Bible. There are no verses in the Bible. Do you think when Matthew was writing his biography of Jesus, which we call a gospel, he went, here's chapter 7, verse 1. No, those were put in 500 years ago to help us navigate the text, which is a really good thing, right? Because without numbers, you wouldn't be able to find yourself around. You know, imagine going to church one morning and the pastor goes, why don't you go about two-thirds of the way through? Let's see if we can find the same spot. No, right? You need numbers. The problem is we tend to think if it's got a number in front of it, we can take it out and make it say whatever we want. Jesus doesn't stop with judge not. What does he say right after that? Judge not. Lest you be judged by the same standard you judge others, you be judged by that standard. So before you try and take the speck out of your brother's eye, take the log out of your own eye first, then you'll be better able to help your brother. Is Jesus telling us not to judge here? No, he's telling us to take the speck out of our brother's eye. That involves making a judgment. He's simply saying, get that problem out of your life first so you can better help your brother. So this is not a command not to judge. It's actually a command on how to judge. It would be completely ridiculous to say don't make judgments. Why? Number one, it's a judgment itself. Number two, you'd be dead already if you didn't make judgments. You made 100 judgments just getting over here tonight. And now you're wondering if it was a good judgment. You're going, this guy's kind of crazy. What? Right? Everybody makes judgments. Atheists make judgments. What judgments do they make? There's no God. Jesus didn't rise from the dead. There's no meaning to life. When you die, you're going to become worm food. It's over. There's no meaning. Have a nice day. No. There's nobody that doesn't make a judgment. Everybody makes judgments. The only question is, are your judgments true? I will say this, though. Jesus did save a very stern rebuke for people who were judgmental. And who were the judgmental ones in his day? Pharisees. Who were the Pharisees? They were the religious and political leaders of Israel. Some of them were on the Sanhedrin, the Jewish ruling council, and Rome delegated a lot of the lawmaking authority to them. They were the politicians, many of them. And Jesus went after these people. Are you telling me Jesus got involved in politics? Yes! And by the way, he wasn't so nice doing it. If you think Jesus was a sweet guy who's never said a bad word about anyone, you have not read John chapter 2, John chapter 8, or Matthew chapter 23. What happens in John chapter 2? Jesus makes a whip and he goes and he jacks people up in the temple. What? Sweet and gentle Jesus did this? Yes. And then in John chapter 8, he's having an argument with these same Pharisees, these political religious leaders, and he gets to the point in the conversation where he says, "Your father is the devil." Jesus, you can't say that. That's not very Christ-like. Excuse me, I am Christ. Can you imagine you're having an argument with somebody and you say, "Your father is the devil"? Never try that with a sibling, by the way, okay? And then in Matthew 23, again, the Pharisees. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Oh, you look great on the outside. You're whitewashed tombs, but on the inside, you're full of dead men's bones. You go a mile to make a convert, and then once you make them a convert, you make them twice as much a son of hell as you are. How will you avoid being condemned to hell?" What? Sweet and gentle Jesus said this? Yes, Jesus was not Barney. "Can't we all get along, boys and girls?" No! "I came to bring a sword. It's going to divide mother and daughter, father and son." Jesus was tough. Don't buy into the wimpified view of Jesus. In fact, why was Jesus killed? Number one, because he claimed to be God, and that was blasphemy to the Jews and sedition to the Romans. And number two is he spoke truth to power, power that wanted him gone, particularly the temple authorities, because if he had succeeded, they knew they were out of business. Caiaphas knew Jesus had resurrected Lazarus from the dead, and what did he say? "It's better that one innocent man die than the whole nation perish." Yeah, miracle would convince me Jesus really was who he said he was. No, it might not. Hearts are set against him. By the way, I've noticed that when you compliment somebody, which is a judgment, did you ever notice that nobody gets upset? You know, if you say to your best friend, "I really love you, you're such a wonderful person, I wish I could be like you," you think your friend's going to say, "Who are you to judge?" Right? No, they're never going to say that. See, I've noticed that people don't have a problem with judging, they just have a problem with judgments they don't like. In fact, if you tell somebody something that's true and they get mad at you, you just help convict them. As Augustine said, we love the truth when it enlightens us. We hate the truth when it convicts us. For you military people in here, and by the way, I was in the Navy, which stands for never again volunteer yourself. You always get more flack when you're over the target. If you tell somebody something that's true and they're shooting back at you, you're over the target. They don't want their evil deeds exposed. As Jesus said, men love darkness rather than light. So don't buy into this idea you can't make judgments. We have to make judgments without being judgmental. In fact, for you Christians in here, somebody put it this way. Evangelism is just one beggar showing another beggar where the food is. None of us are making it to heaven without Jesus. So why do we think we're any better than anybody else? We're not. Now, we could spend more time on this, but we got to move on to the next point. I just want to make sure that everybody can see that this statement right here shoots itself. Can everybody see that? And all the other statements we just went through, they're all self-defeating. They can't be true, which means that relativism and postmodernism can't be true because they claim it's true, that there's no truth, and that's great. Why? Because, I don't know, what do you pay here, 30, 40 grand a year to be here? You're here to learn truth, right? If there was no truth, you're wasting your time. You're wasting your money, but you're here to learn truth. So the next question is it true that God exists? But before we get to that, I just need to say one more thing briefly. A little bit later, we're going to have a Q&A mic. And if you're an atheist, thank you for being here, or any non-Christian. And if you want to ask a question, I just want to warn you that I may ask you a question back. And it's not fair for me to do that unless I warn you in advance. So here's the question I might ask you. The question is, if Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? I've had atheists stand at the microphone in front of hundreds of people and say, "No, No. How's that reasonable? How's that rational? It's not. The problem isn't here. The problem's here. They don't want it to be true. They don't want there to be a God. Why? They want to be God of their own lives. They're not on a truth quest. They're on a happiness quest. And they're just going to believe whatever they think is going to make them happy. And in fact, some Christians do this too. We have a lot of inconvenient doctrines, don't we? Oh, yeah, I disagree with Jesus on that one. Really? You call yourself a Christian, you disagree with Jesus? I never thought of that. Are we on a truth quest or a happiness quest? So just get ready. I may ask you that question, okay? The truth is out there. The question is, will we accept it? So is it true that God exists? And we're going to spend most of our time, actually, the majority of our time on point two. You're going to go, wow, how is he going to get through this? Points three and four go quickly once point two is established, okay? So let's talk about the three arguments I mentioned for the existence of God. The first argument is the argument from the beginning of the universe known as the cosmological argument. Now, cosmological stands for the Greek word cosmos, or comes from the Greek word cosmos, which means world or universe. And it says if the universe had a beginning, it must have had a beginner. The second argument is the argument from design known as the teleological argument. Telos is a Greek word meaning design or purpose. And it says if there's design in the universe and design in you, life, then there must be a designer. Now, the third argument doesn't have any science behind it like these two do. Yet it's the argument we've all known since we were very small children. It's more of a philosophical argument. And it's the argument from morality known as the moral argument. And it says if there's one thing morally wrong out there, just one, like it's wrong to torture babies for fun, or it's wrong to murder 6 million people in a Holocaust, then there has to be a God. Why? Because if there is no standard beyond humanity, then everything's just a matter of opinion. That's just your opinion against a baby torturer's opinion, or your opinion against Hitler's opinion. We know these issues aren't just a matter of opinion. If that's the case, there must be an external standard beyond us, a moral righteous standard that we're obligated to obey, and any deviation from that standard would be what we would call evil. That standard is what we call God's nature. Whatever God is, he is good, and that is his nature. If God doesn't exist, nothing's ultimately objectively right or wrong. Now, we'll get to that later, but we got to start right here at point one, the cosmological argument. Now, you got to admit, it was worth coming out here tonight just to see God do that. Now, some of you are saying, I've never seen God move. Oh, really? Check this out. Now, this is the argument that many say points back to the big...
Now, I know there's some Christians in here going, Frank, we don't believe in the Big Bang.
You guys don't believe in the Big Bang? I believe in the Big Bang. I just know who banged it. In fact, the evidence for the Big Bang is so good that even atheistic physicists are admitting it. Stephen Hawking, who was probably the top most well-known physicist in the world until he died about 4 years ago of ALS. You know, Hawking was kind of a medical miracle. He had ALS. It normally kills you in 3 or 4 years. He had it for like 40 years. Anyway, here's what Hawking said about the beginning. He said, almost everyone now believes that the universe and time itself had a beginning at the Big Bang. Now, Hawking tried to come up with another explanation other than God. He failed. But he's admitting the data, that space, time, and matter had a beginning out of nothing, out of non-being. What's nothing? Aristotle had a good definition of nothing. He said, nothing is what rocks dream about. That's nothing. It wasn't just Hawking. Alexander Vilenkin, Russian cosmologist, originally from Russia, but now teaches at Tufts University, wrote a book called Many Worlds in One, where he tried to put forth the idea that there were multiple universes out there. But even Vilenkin admits that even if there are multiple universes, the whole show needs an absolute beginning. In fact, here's what he said. He said, with the proof now in place, cosmologists, by the way, a cosmologist is not someone that puts on your makeup, all right? A cosmologist is someone that studies the universe. Cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is now no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning. Two interesting words in this quote. First word, proof. Unusual for scientists to use the word proof. Why? Because science is tentative. It can always be overcome by more discoveries. It's inductive. But Vilenkin sees so many lines of evidence crossing at one single point, namely the universe had a beginning, that he says it constitutes a proof. The other interesting word is the word problem. Why is it a problem that there was a cosmic beginning? Because if all of nature had a beginning, whatever created nature can't be made of nature. It must be something beyond nature. It must be something supernature, something beyond space, time, and matter. Now, we're not going to go through the evidence for this tonight. Why? Number one, we don't have time. Number two, it's all in the book, chapter three. And number three, it's not controversial. Atheists and agnostics are admitting that space, time, and matter had a beginning out of nothing. So what we're going to do is just jump to the bottom line. And that's this. If the universe had a beginning, it seems it must have had a beginner. We've got two options. Either no one created something out of nothing, which is the atheistic view, or someone created something out of nothing, which is the theistic view. Now, here's my only question. Which view is more reasonable? That no one created something out of nothing, or that someone created something out of nothing? What do you think? Number two, I had someone at Texas A&M said, number one. And I said, time out. Let's look at number two for a second. Number two says, someone created something out of nothing. Now, that's a miracle, right? But at least you got a miracle worker. You got someone. Number one is a miracle with no miracle worker. That's clearly absurd. You say, well, who's putting forth this? Well, a guy like Lawrence Krauss. He used to teach at Arizona State University. He had a book out called The Universe from Nothing, where he tries to say how the universe could come into existence out of nothing without a cause. And the problem was his nothing wasn't nothing. It was actually something. It was a quantum vacuum. It wasn't nothing. So he didn't succeed, as even most atheists will admit in his attempt there. But ladies and gentlemen, do you realize that everybody believes in at least one miracle? Christians believe in more than one, but we certainly believe in this miracle. Someone created something out of nothing. Do you know what atheists believe? They believe that no one created something out of nothing. At least some of them do. Everybody believes in at least one miracle. In fact, I said to the audience that night at Texas A&M, I said, to show you how seriously we all take the law of causality. And by the way, the law of causality doesn't say everything has a cause. It says that everything that comes to be has a cause. There has to be an uncaused first cause. It's either the universe or something outside the universe. So I said to the audience that night at A&M, I said, to show you how seriously we all take the law of causality, that things don't pop into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause. There is nobody who's sitting here in this auditorium tonight who is currently worried that as you sit here, a hippopotamus has appeared out of nothing and is currently pooping on your pillow in your dorm room, right? You're not worried about that, right? In fact, you're not worried that a raging Bengal tiger is just going to appear out of nothing right here in this auditorium and start charging into people. You're not worried about that. Why? Because you know that things don't pop into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause. So why would anyone suggest that the whole universe could do so? I mean, if things could pop into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause, why doesn't everything do that? Why don't Teslas pop into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause? You wake up one morning, your Hyundai is a Tesla. You go, how do I charge this thing, right? Why don't MacBook Pros pop into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause? Could have saved me $4,000. Windows is better. Well, yeah. Yeah, yeah. You and all those viruses. All right. suppose you want to have a pizza tonight after this thing, and you're really hungry, so you go home. Should you order one, or should you just sit in your kitchen and hope one pops into existence out of nothing, by nothing, without a cause? No. It seems to me the atheists have all the faith. In fact, here's a question to ask an atheist. This comes from the philosopher Leibniz. If there is no God, why is there something rather than nothing at all? If there is no God, why does anything exist, in other words? Now think about this, ladies and gentlemen. If space, time, and matter literally had a beginning out of nothing, whatever created space, time, and matter can't be made of space, time, and matter. In other words, the cause must be spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, personal, in order to choose to create. Because in order to create from nothing, someone has to make a choice, and only persons can make choices. The being would also have to be intelligent to have a mind to make a choice. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when you think about a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, personal, intelligent cause, who do you think of? God. You say, well, how do you know it's the Christian God, Frank? We don't. Yet. We haven't done enough research yet. But if we continue to go through these questions, I think we'll realize that the same being that walked out of the tomb 1,988 years ago is the same being in whose divine nature created the universe out of nothing. We haven't established that yet. All we've established is we have a being that looks like it could be the God of the Bible. This could be Allah or some other God at this point, but we seem to have a creator God. Now, the next argument is the argument from design known as the teleological argument, and there are two aspects to this argument. One aspect is the fact that the universe appears designed. The second aspect is the fact that you appear to be designed. Life appears to be designed. Let's just start with the universe first. This is known as the fine-tuning of the universe. Scientists have discovered in recent decades that the universe is so precisely tweaked that if you were to change any one of a number of factors virtually imperceptibly about our universe, there would be no universe, or there would certainly be no universe that could support life. And change any one of a number of these factors, we're not here. We'll start with atheist Stephen Hawking again, who talked about the expansion rate of the universe this way. He said, if the expansion rate of the universe was different by one part in 1,000,000,000,000,000 a second after the Big Bang, the universe would have collapsed back on itself or never developed galaxies. If the expansion rate was that infinitesimally different at the very beginning, none of us would be here. Now, you can't make any sort of evolutionary explanation for this. Why? Because the expansion rate did not evolve to a certain point by chance, whatever that means. It started there. It's one of the initial conditions of the universe. Seems to me the same being that created space, time, and matter is the same being that fine-tuned the expansion rate to be precisely what it needed to be. Also, the gravitational force, if it were altered by more than 1 in 10 to the 40th power, we wouldn't be here. What's 1 in 10 to the 40th power? That's one part in 1 with 40 zeros following it. You say, Frank, I can't get my head around that number. I know, neither can I. So let me give an illustration. Take a tape measure and stretch it across the entire known universe. That's a long way. You can't get that tape measure at Lowe's. Set the gravitational force at a particular inch mark on that tape measure. I realize gravity's not measured in inches, but this is just to give you a scale idea in your mind. If the strength of gravity were different by 1 inch in either direction across the scale as wide as the entire known universe, we would not be here. That's 1 in 10 to the 40 precision. I don't have enough faith to believe that that value just landed there by chance. And oh, by the way, is chance a cause? Does chance cause things? Who caused this? Chance. He was just here. No. Chance is not a cause. Chance is a word we use to describe mathematical possibilities. You know what scientists mean when they use the word chance? We don't know. Look, there's only two reasons for that value being right where it is. Either that value was designed to be there or it wasn't. What makes more sense? Somebody designed it to be right where it is. Any different, we wouldn't be here. And we could go through a dozen more of these factors. Change any one of them, we're not here. This is why even Christopher Hitchens, the great atheist who I had a couple of debates with a number of years ago, who was brilliant because he had a British accent that made him sound even more brilliant. Even he said, man, the fine-tuning argument is the best argument because we just, there's no explanation for it. But it's not just the universe that appears fine-tuned. Our solar system appears to be fine-tuned. Let's take a look at our solar system. It's designed with us in mind. Here we are. If we were just a little bit closer to or a little bit further away from the sun, we couldn't survive. A little bit closer to, we'd burn up. A little bit further away, we'd freeze. We are what scientists call the Goldilocks zone. It's not too hot. It's not too cold. It is? That's a lie. It's too hot here in the summer. Axial tilt, 23.5 degrees. Change that slightly, we don't exist. Earth rotation, 24 hours. Change that slightly, we don't exist. The size and distance of the moon from us. Change that slightly, we don't exist. If Jupiter right here was not in its current orbit, we couldn't exist here on Earth. What does Jupiter do for us? Its gravitational force is so strong, it attracts most of the meteors and space junk to it rather than us. It's a cosmic vacuum cleaner. In fact, if you take a close-up look at Jupiter, you know what these dark marks are? Those are comet fragment strikes that are bigger than the Earth. Thank God for Jupiter. Because if Jupiter wasn't there, we wouldn't be here. Same thing is true with Saturn. In fact, let's take a look at the planets here. There you got Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Earth. Look at poor Pluto down here. Pluto recently has been demoted as a planet. I don't know about you, but I think it's size discrimination. Take a look at this. You can hardly see Pluto. Take a look at this. This is Arcturus, another star in our galaxy. This is in our galaxy, not outside our galaxy. Here's the sun over here. Jupiter is one pixel in size on this scale. Earth is invisible. Pluto, forget about it. All right, keep an eye on Arcturus now. Where's Arcturus now? Way over here, right of Regal. That's Antares. That's another star in our galaxy. The sun is one pixel in size on this scale. Jupiter is invisible. Earth, Pluto, forget about them. In fact, if the Earth was the size of a golf ball, Betelgeuse here. Look, I don't name the stars, okay? If the Earth was the size of a golf ball, Betelgeuse would be 5 or 6 Empire State Buildings high. The heavens are awesome. And that's just in our galaxy. This is not outside our galaxy. This is inside our galaxy. And the average distance between stars in our galaxy is 30 trillion miles. And all that distance is necessary for us to exist here on Earth. Now, 30 trillion miles, how far is that? Far. Take you at least 2 tanks of gas and a Toyota Prius to go 30 trillion miles. Number of years ago, my wife and I took our sons to the Desert Museum in Tucson, Arizona. If you ever get to go there at night, on a clear night, you can see thousands of stars in the sky. So we're out there one night. This is like 25 years ago. And the guide says, wow, it's so clear tonight that if we look up at 9:03, we'll see the space shuttle in orbit. I said, oh, come on, we're not going to see the space shuttle. It's only 120 feet long. It's 350 miles up. We're not going to see it. Oh, me of little faith. At 9:03, the guide goes, look! And we look up in the sky, and about 70 degrees above the horizon, there's an object streaking out of the western desert sky relative to us about like this. I mean, it's really cooking. When it got right about here, it disappeared. I don't know whether Scotty beamed it up or what. Actually, what happened was, despite the fact that we were in total darkness, the space shuttle was so high up that the sun was still reflecting off of it, and we got out of the range of the sun, we couldn't see it anymore. Now, when the space shuttle was in orbit, the space shuttle was traveling at about 18,000 miles an hour. That's 5 miles per second. You got trouble getting to school in the morning? Take the space shuttle! 5 miles a second. Think about how fast that is. Well, I did a little calculation to try and figure out how long would it take us if we could get in the space shuttle and go from our star, the sun, to another star an average distance away in our galaxy, 30 trillion miles. In other words, how long would it take us to go 30 trillion miles if we could go 5 miles per second? How long do you think it would take us? A long time. You must be a math major. Yeah. It would take us 201,450 years. That means if you got in the space shuttle at the time of Christ and started traveling from our star, the sun, to another star inside our galaxy, an average distance away, you've been going 5 miles a second for 2,000 years. You would be less than 1/100th of the way there right now. And we're going to explore space. No, we're not. We're not going anywhere in space. We can hardly get out of our solar system. Took us 9 years to get to Pluto. And how high are the heavens? Well, the psalmist says this. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those that fear him. How high are the heavens above the earth? The Hubble Space Telescope helped us discover that. A number of years ago, they trained the Hubble Space Telescope on 1/24 millionth of the sky. What's 1/24 millionth of the sky? Go outside tonight, put a piece of rice on the end of your finger, hold it up. That piece of rice represents about 1/24 millionth of the sky. And they trained Hubble on that for several days. This is called Hubble Ultra Deep Field. You can Google this. You can find this video online. It's in the public domain. What is Hubble Ultra Deep Field? I don't know if you can see this, but along the bottom of this slide here, these are mountains. This is the southern hemisphere. I'm going to show you the video they compiled from Hubble Ultra Deep Field, what they found in 1/24 millionth of the sky. When I start the video, the constellations are going to come up, and then Hubble is going to zoom in on that tiny dot. There is no audio. It's just video. You ready? Here it is. Hubble Ultra Deep Field. There are the constellations. Let's go see what's in 1/24 millionth of the sky. What you're looking at are nearly 10,000 galaxies, each with billions of stars apiece. Now you know why the Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God. And how many stars are there in the entire universe? Researchers at the University of Hawaii think they figured it out. The number of stars in the universe are about equivalent to the number of grains of sand on all the beaches, on all the earth, times 100,000. And to go from one star to another star, just in our galaxy, going 5 miles a second, will take you over 200,000 years. Bearcats, I don't ever want to hear ever any one of you ever again use the word awesome for anything other than the heavens or God. Awesome shirt, dude. Awesome shot, dude. Awesome TikTok video. No! We're polluting the language here. By the way, that's not the end of that verse in Psalms. Here's what it says. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. This being that created and sustains all these stars is the same being that entered humanity to take our punishment on himself, because his love exceeds the height of the heavens above the earth. Now, when you think about the number of stars equivalent to sand grains on 100,000 earths, does that make you feel insignificant? It shouldn't. Why? Because the heavens aren't made in the image of God, but you are. In fact, this is you in the womb at 11 weeks. So the heavens are fine-tuned. Now let's look at life. This is you in the womb at 11 weeks. Question, is this animal, mineral, vegetable, or human? Human. In fact, let's go back before 11 weeks. Let's go all the way back to when your mother and your father got together to conceive you. Have you guys had this talk before? I see some young people in here, so I'll try and be discreet. I also see some older people in here, so I'll try and be discreet as well, just in case you've forgotten how this works. When your mother and father got together to conceive you, your mother unconsciously perfumed her egg to attract your father, and then your father sent the entire population of the United States, 300 million soldiers, toward your mother's egg. And then there was a race, and you won. That's right. Don't let anyone ever tell you you're not special. You beat out 300 million others. You have blown away anything Michael Phelps has done. Now, seeing some of you limp in here earlier makes it hard for me to believe you were the fastest soldier in the gene pool, but you were. Now, your soldier was 20 to 30 times smaller than a grain of salt, yet it contained half of the 3.2 billion letter genome, your DNA, all the letters in the right order, and your mother's egg was about the size of a period at the end of a sentence in an average book, and it contained the other half of the 3.2 billion letter genome, all the letters in the right order. And when your egg and your soldier came together, a new 100% genetic human being was created. You know, you have not received any more genetic information from this point until right now. In fact, there's only four things that separated you from adulthood: time, air, water, and food. Those are the same four things that separate a two-year-old from adulthood. Does this have implications on the abortion issue? Yeah, I think it does. We don't kill the two-year-old. Why do we kill the unborn child in the womb? Genetically, it's the same. You say, wait a minute, Frank, time out. You can't legislate morality. All right, no extra charge for this. This comes from our first book, creatively titled Legislating Morality. All laws legislate morality. Every law declares one behavior right and the opposite behavior wrong. You can't think of a law which doesn't legislate morality. The only question is, whose morality will we legislate? And when people say to me, hey, you can't impose your morality on me, I go, why not? Would that be immoral? Actually, they're actually doing the same thing they tell me I can't do. They're saying I ought not impose ought nots, but they're imposing that their ought not on me. That I ought not impose my ought nots. Well, wait a minute. Why do you get to impose your morality, but I don't get to impose mine? Actually, that's not the right answer. The right answer is this. When somebody says, don't impose your morality on me, this isn't my morality. I didn't make this stuff up. I didn't make up the fact that murder's wrong, that abortion's wrong, that rape is wrong, that theft is wrong, that men were made for women and women were made for men, and the best way to perpetuate and stabilize society, which is the reason the government's involved in marriage to begin with, is to legally recognize the man-woman relationship over every other relationship. I didn't make any of this stuff up. This isn't my morality. This isn't your morality. This just happens to be the morality. The one Thomas Jefferson said was self-evident. The one the Apostle Paul said, the Gentiles are not of the law, have the law written on their hearts. It's not my morality, it's not your morality, it's the morality. And if you have a problem with the morality, you don't have a problem with me. You have a problem with the Creator upon whose nature this morality is derived. All right, no extra charge for that. Let's go back to this. From this point till right now, a construction project of astonishing complexity began taking place. Cells began multiplying at a rate of 4,000 cells per second. Brain cells began multiplying at a rate of 100,000 cells per second. For most of you, anyway. Some cells became brain cells, others lung cells, others heart cells. How did they know how to do this? Nobody knows. Some cells went so far across you to become what they needed to become that it would be equivalent to you today walking across the United States alone. And that construction project continues to this very moment. You just made 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million. Knock it off! How is this happening? Are you thinking about this? Are you going, wait a minute, Frank, time out. I got to concentrate. New red blood cells coming up. No, this is just happening. How is it happening? Aristotle recognized something 2,400 years ago. He didn't know anything about blood cells, but he did notice that all of nature's going in a direction consistently. You ever notice that an acorn, if it's properly nourished, always becomes an oak tree? Why doesn't it become an elm tree or a birch tree or a seahorse? Well, it's programmed to become an oak tree. Well, who programmed it? And by the way, is an acorn conscious? Is an acorn in the ground going, all right, what do I have to do to become an oak tree? No, but it reliably goes in the direction of becoming an oak tree. If it doesn't have a mind of its own, there must be an external mind directing it toward an end. Aristotle called this the unmoved mover. Thomas Aquinas came along in the 1200s and said, this is going to be my fifth way to argue for God, that all of nature's going in a direction. It's going toward a target, a final cause. If it's going in a direction, if it doesn't have a mind of its own, there must be an external mind directing it. Now, this is not a Big Bang cause way back when. In fact, Aristotle mistakenly thought the universe was eternal. He's not talking about a cause way back when. He's talking about a cause every single second the universe exists. Because every single second the universe exists, these laws, by the way, these laws which govern physical things and all physical things change, do you notice the laws don't change? Why don't they? Where do laws come from? They come from lawgivers. Why is everything so orderly going in a direction? Because it's being driven by a mind every single second of existence. In fact, God is to the universe what a band is to music. If a band were up here playing the music, it would be creating and sustaining the music. What happens to the music the second the band stops playing? Music's over. This is why Paul comes along and he says, in Jesus we live and move and have our being. And Christ holds all things together. And the writer of Hebrews says, God sustains all things by his powerful word. God creates, yes, but he also sustains. There's a lot more about that argument in the book, Stealing from God. But we have to move on to our final argument for God, and that is the moral argument. Let me ask you guys a question. How do you know that your quarterback throwing a touchdown is better than your quarterback throwing a pick six? How do you know that? Wins. Now you're getting at something. It's not just the rules. You have to know the purpose of the game, right? If you know the purpose of the game, then you can see that a touchdown for your side is better than your side throwing a pick six, right? If there's no purpose to the game, you can't say a touchdown's better than an interception. Because without a best, you can't say a play is good, which is getting you closer to the goal, or bad, taking you further away from the goal. Now, what does this have to do with morality? Well, notice in football, the purpose of the game comes from outside the game. In other words, the commissioner and the owners get together every year. They tweak the rules a little bit. But the players don't show up on the field and say, what's the purpose of this game? No. The purpose is established before they ever walk into the stadium. And then they can judge whether a play is good or bad. Well, the same thing is true in life, except the rules aren't arbitrary. They're arbitrary in football. They're not arbitrary in life. The purpose of life is to know God and to make him known, to love God and love one another. That's why there are certain rules that say this gets you closer to that purpose or goal and this takes you further away. If there's no God, that means there's no purpose, which means there's no right way to live life or wrong way to live life. If there are no rules or purpose to a game, there's no right way to play it or wrong way to play it. Do you realize that if there is no God, the Nazis were not wrong? It's just your opinion. How did we convict the Nazis? They said, we're just following orders. And we said, you have a moral obligation to disobey immoral orders because there's a standard beyond your government called international law. C.S. Lewis called it the moral law. Thomas Jefferson, in the Declaration of Independence, called it nature's law. It's God's nature. You have a moral obligation to disobey immoral orders. You didn't do it. Look, if your worldview is telling you the Nazis weren't wrong, you've got the wrong worldview. If there is no God, then love is no better than rape. Oh, you may like love better, but it's not objectively better because there's no purpose. If there is no God, there are no human rights. Every campus has people advocating for certain rights. Do you realize there are no rights unless God exists? It's just your opinion against somebody else's opinion. In fact, if there is no God, racism isn't wrong. Slavery isn't wrong. Murder isn't wrong. Nothing's wrong because nothing's right. If there is no God, tolerance is no better than intolerance. By the way, are Christians commanded to be tolerant? No, tolerance is too weak. Tolerance says hold your nose and put up with them. Love says reach out and help them. And sometimes to love people, you can't tolerate the evil they want to do. How many people in here are parents? How many people in here are former children? Okay, good. That should be all of us then. Let me ask you a question. If a parent approves of everything his or her child wants to do, is that parent loving? No. Love does not mean approval like our culture thinks it does. Well, if you love me, you'll approve of what I do. No, I might not approve of what you do because I love you. Also, you can't complain about the problem of evil because evil proves God does exist. Wait a minute. What do you mean evil proves God does exist? Well, C.S. Lewis, who lived through awful World War I, he was in it, came out of there going, there can't be a good God. There's too much injustice in the world. And then one day he had an epiphany. He realized his argument didn't work. And here's what he wrote in Mere Christianity. He said, as an atheist, my argument against God was that the universe seems so cruel and unjust. But how had I gotten this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? You see, you wouldn't know what a crooked line was unless you knew what a straight line was. You wouldn't know what injustice was unless you knew what justice was. Something can't be immoral unless something is. Something can't be not right unless something is. So evil doesn't disprove God, because nothing would be evil unless there was a standard of good. But there wouldn't be a standard of good, not an objective standard, unless God existed. So evil doesn't disprove God. It may prove there's a devil out there, but it doesn't disprove God, because nothing would be evil unless there was a standard of good. And God is what we mean by the standard of good. You say, what do you mean by that? What do you mean evil isn't? I mean, can't evil coexist? Aren't they equal and opposite forces? No, evil is a lack in a good thing. Evil is like cancer. If you take all the cancer out of a good body, what do you got? You got a better body. What happens if you take all the body out of the cancer? It doesn't exist. Evil is like rust in a car. If you take all the rust out of a car, what do you got? You got a better car. What happens if you take all the car out of the rust? It doesn't exist. In other words, evil is a parasite in good. It can't exist without good. You could put it this way. The shadows prove the sunshine. In order to have shadows, you have to have sunshine. In other words, in order to have evil, you have to have good. Oh, you can have sunshine without shadows. You can have good without evil. But you can't have shadows without sunshine. You can't have evil without good. So if evil exists, and we all know it does, then God exists. I know this is counterintuitive, but it's true. All right, last thing on this. What does the word submit mean? Nobody likes this word. What does it mean? Come under someone's mission. Yeah, let's break it up into two. Submission. What does mission mean? It means there's a goal, there's a purpose, there's a direction we should be taking. And sub just means you're putting your own personal mission underneath, and you're abdicating your own personal mission to contribute to this other mission. So look. If I'm a diva receiver on the team and I go, keep throwing me the ball, man, keep throwing me the ball. And the coach goes, man, we are not going to win if we keep throwing you the ball. We got to spread the ball around. And I go, okay, I get it, coach. If we want to win, I got to take my personal mission and submit it to the overall mission. Well, the question is, what is the overall mission of life? You realize that if God exists, and he does, that we would all be foolish if we were to take our own personal mission and put it over the ultimate mission. If we don't submit ourselves to the true mission, we're going to be foolish, because, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be dead a lot longer than we're going to be alive. All right, so what can we draw from these three conclusions, or these three arguments, I should say? I think from these three arguments, we can conclude we have a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, personal, intelligent creator who created all things and sustains all things and is moral. Now, these are the attributes of the God of the Bible, and we haven't even opened the Bible yet. This is called natural theology. You don't need any written text to figure out that God exists. In fact, the Bible even tells you that in Romans chapter 1. This being exists. You might say, well, Frank, atheists have good reasons against this, don't they? I don't think so. In fact, if atheism's true, you shouldn't trust your reason. I can't say anything better than C.S. Lewis, so I'm just going to read you what Lewis wrote. See if you can track along with this. It's a two-slide quote. Here's what Lewis said. Suppose that there were no intelligence behind the universe. In that case, nobody designed my brain for the purpose of thinking. Thought is merely the byproduct of some atoms within my skull. But if so, how can I trust my own thinking to be true? You with him so far? Okay, here's what how he finishes. But if I can't trust my own thinking, of course I can't trust the arguments leading to atheism and therefore have no reason to be an atheist or anything else. Unless I believe in God, I can't believe in thought, so I can never use thought to disbelieve in God. Boom. Look, if we're just moist robots, if we're driven completely by the laws of physics, as many atheists say we are, why should we think anything's true? We shouldn't even believe our own thoughts. So, how are we going to discover who the true God is? For that, we got to go to miracles. Now, this is the shortest of the four, so this isn't going to take long, but we got to deal with it very briefly here. We know the truth exists and God exists. How are we going to know which God is the true God? Well, God can use miracles to tell us. Now, a lot of people think miracles are impossible. For example, Noah. Hey, Christians. You Christians in here? Can we just keep something between ourselves? Can we all agree that Noah, I don't care if the ark encounters 45 minutes from here, okay? Can we all agree that Noah and the ark is crazy? Thank you. And a resurrection. How many people in here have seen somebody rise from the dead? Yeah, none of us have. Yet our entire faith is built on believing something that none of us have ever seen. How rational is that? And for some reason, the big problem miracle in the Bible is Jonah. Is that a whale of a tale or a tale of a whale? I mean, what is the deal with Jonah? Can you really believe in Jonah? Well, what is the greatest miracle in the Bible? Yeah, the greatest miracle in the Bible is not the resurrection. The greatest miracle in the Bible is... I got some of you a second time. Yes. The greatest miracle in the Bible is the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, even the atheists are admitting the data for this miracle. They're admitting that space, time, and matter had a beginning out of nothing. Well, if that's the case, then these other miracles are at least possible. Of course Noah's crazy, unless God exists. Of course resurrections make no sense and can't occur unless God exists. Of course Jonah is a fairy tale, unless God exists. I mean, if he can create the whole show out of nothing, can he do whatever he wants that's not logically impossible inside the universe? If he can create the whole show out of nothing, of course he can. Now, a lot of people here are going to say, Frank, well, I can't believe something I've never seen. You believe in a lot of things you've never seen. You believe in your mind. Have you ever seen it? You're using it right now. You believe in the laws of logic and the laws of mathematics. Have you ever seen those? No, I haven't seen them. You believe in justice. You ever seen justice? Oh, you may have seen justice done, but you've never seen justice. It's not a physical thing. It's an immaterial reality grounded in the nature of God. You've never seen love. And everyone in here believes in it. What is love? You know, a student at College of New Jersey, where we had our debate with Christopher Hitchens, our second debate, which you can see on our YouTube channel, a student asked Hitchens this question. What is love, Christopher? And Hitchens, being a materialist, had to come up with a materialistic answer, so he said, love is a chemical. And I said, don't say that to your wife. Honey, do you love me? Yeah. Why? Because I got the chemical. I might not have it tomorrow. No, love is not a chemical. It's an immaterial virtue grounded in the nature of God. It's a decision to seek what's best for the other person. It's not a chemical. You've never seen gravity. Oh, Frank, come on. There it is right there. No, you're not seeing gravity. What are you seeing? You're seeing the effects of gravity. We really don't even know what gravity is. You know that? We're just seeing the effect. That, by the way, that's how we know God exists. We know God by his effects. The creation is an effect. We reason back to a cause, a creator. Design is an effect. We reason back to a cause, a designer. A moral law is an effect. We reason back to a cause, a moral lawgiver. This is what scientists do. They reason from effect back to cause. When someone asks you, how do you know God exists? You say, because I know God by his effects. Reason. We can reason. I'm reasoning back to a mind. You've never seen George Washington, but you believe he exists. In fact, you've never seen the guy whose name's on that building over there. What's it? McKinnick? Did I get that right? Huh? Micken. Yeah, you've never seen the guy. Have you? Some of you don't want to see the guy, right? But you believe he existed. He's got his name on a building. He's left effects behind that are best explained by George Washington or McMicken or whatever. And that's how you know God exists. And that's how you know Jesus existed. He's leaving effects behind. Regardless of the Holy Spirit, I'm just saying, you know, just by evidence that this being, this person existed. Now, if miracles do occur, and by the way, you don't need a single miracle to occur since the New Testament for Christianity to be true. I think miracles have occurred, and you can get Craig Keener's hernia-inducing two-volume set called Miracles, because he has investigated modern-day miracles and has a lot of evidence for them. But even if he's all wrong about that, Christianity is still true. But if miracles do occur, they occur very rarely. Why? Because if they occurred all the time, they wouldn't get our attention. I mean, imagine if people rose from the dead routinely. What would the resurrection of Jesus mean to us? Nothing. You go to somebody and go, Jesus rose from the dead to prove he was God. And the guy goes, so what? Uncle Leroy just rose from the dead 2 weeks ago. Now I got to give the inheritance back. No, it's got to be a rare event. It can't be a regular event. Miracles have to be rare if they're going to get our attention. Do you realize this, though, for atheism to be true? Every single spiritual experience and miracle claim in the history of the world has to be false. Is that possible? Yeah, possible. Is it reasonable? I don't think so. There's a lot more in the book on miracles, but we got to wrap this up by getting to the key question, is the New Testament true? Now, we don't have to prove the Bible's inerrant or any of that. We're just trying to see if the essentials of Christianity are true. What we want to discover is, did Jesus actually die and then rise from the dead? Because if he did, then the Christian God is the true God. And there's a lot of evidence he did. I'm going to give you six lines of evidence. We only have time to look at two, okay? They all begin with the letter E. The first is we have early sources. The second is we have eyewitness details. There are scores of eyewitness details that only an eyewitness would know. We have embarrassing stories. I'll explain that in a minute, as well as excruciating deaths. Those are the two we're going to look at. We have embedded confirmation. This is hard to explain in a short period of time, so let me just give you two words to Google if you want to learn about this, because I think this, number five here, is the best evidence you've probably never heard of that the New Testament writers are individually telling or individually witnessing the same historical events. Google two words, undesigned coincidences. Undesigned coincidences. There are entire books written on this. There's even free books on the internet you can get. And when you get undesigned coincidences, which I call embedded confirmation, you'll see these guys couldn't have made this up. There's expected predictions that deals with Old Testament prophecy. If I only had one Old Testament prophecy to make my case on, it would be Isaiah 53, written 700 years in advance. There's also extra-biblical writers. Those are 10 ancient non-Christian sources that lived within 150 years of Jesus' life. And when you take their joint references, who are these people? People like Josephus, Suetonius, Thallus, Phlegon. These are all household names I know. When you take their brief references to Jesus and the apostles and you compile them together, you get a story congruent with the New Testament. And finally, you have the explosive growth of the church out of Jerusalem, which is really hard to explain because Christianity could have ended and been ended immediately if either the Jews or the Romans went to the tomb and had taken Jesus' dead body out of the tomb. And they couldn't do that. They wanted to do that, but they couldn't do that. Why? Because Jesus was still using his body. It's really hard to explain how Christianity, which started with an empirical claim that Jesus rose from the dead, survived if Jesus' tomb was known, and it was. How could it have survived if his body was in there? It couldn't. Now, as I say, we don't have time to go all through all this. But let's deal a little bit with embarrassing stories. What are embarrassing stories? Embarrassing stories normally tell historians that if there's something embarrassing to the author or authors, it's probably true. Why would it be true, do you think? This is the interactive portion of the program. Okay, I'll give you a hint. Yeah, you want to. You're not going to make yourself look bad. You're not going to embarrass yourself. You're probably going to make yourself look better if you're inventing a story, right? You're not going to embarrass yourself. That's why we call this the dove factor, because the New Testament writers have filled the New Testament with embarrassing details they never would have invented. In fact, let me put it this way. How many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look good? If you don't have your hand up right now, you're lying to make yourself look good. And it's not working. We know you're lying. All right, how many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look bad? You rarely do. You won't do that, right? Unless you're trying to snow somebody short for a short period of time, right? No, you don't lie to make yourself look bad. You might lie to make yourself look good. Well, the New Testament is filled with embarrassing details they never would have invented. For example, Peter, their leader, is called Satan by Jesus. You think they made this up? You think at one point Mark said to Peter, hey, Pete, I'm going to make this a real interesting story. I'm going to have the Lord call you Satan. What do you think Peter would have said? Have him call you Satan. Look, I'm the leader here. This is embarrassing. And then Peter says, Lord, I'll never deny you. What does he wind up doing? He denies him three times. And then later in the book of Galatians, this is in the Bible, Paul says that he has to dope slap Peter for not obeying the right theology there. This is in the Bible. He's actually correcting another apostle. This is embarrassing. And then, of course, you know, at the crucifixion, all the disciples, with the exception maybe of John, they all run away. This is like a Monty Python movie. Run away! And who are the brave ones? The women. The women are the brave ones. Now, who wrote the New Testament down? Men. Now, what man is going to invent that he was hiding for fear of the Jews, why the women went down and discovered the empty tomb? Would any man in here invent that? No, if I was inventing it, I'd make myself look good, wouldn't you? I'd write something down like this. Let's see, we marched right down there, we overpowered that elite Roman guard. Yeah, that sounds pretty good. What do you think? John said, get out. Peter roundhouse kicked him. Philip said, we'll be back. And then on Sunday morning, we marched right down to the tomb, and we saw Jesus, who congratulated us on our great faith. And then we went and comforted the trembling women. I would never say I was Mr. Wimpy Pants. Why the women went down and discovered the empty tomb. And oh, by the way, why would you never say the women were the first witnesses in that culture? Forget about the fact it was embarrassing to men. It was. But why would you never say the women were the first witnesses if you're trying to pass off a lie as the truth? Why? That's right. Their testimony was not considered on par with that of a man. So if you're making up the New Testament story, you'd only have the men be the first witnesses. Yet all four Gospels say the women were the first witnesses, which is telling us what? They really were, as embarrassing as it was. I actually had a woman once. She came up to me and she said, Frank, I know why Jesus appeared to the women first. I said, why? And she said, because he wanted to get the story out. I said, that is an excellent point. Because, ladies, when your man comes home from work, does he say much? There could have been a nuclear explosion down at the plant. He's not going to tell you. You'll see it on the news before you hear it from him. You'll be watching the news going, hey, hon, what? Oh, yeah, forgot to tell you the nuke blew up. I've been hot for 3 days. What's for dinner? Right? He's not going to tell you. I can't even believe this next verse is actually in the New Testament, but it is. It's Matthew 28:17. Matthew 28:19 is the Great Commission. Jesus is giving them the Great Commission. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations. Notice he doesn't say make believers. He says make disciples. There's a difference. Anyway, right there in verse 17, as he's gathering all these people around him, it says that some of his disciples believed, but some doubted. He's standing, resurrected, right in front of them, and they're doubting. It's like they're standing there going, you see that guy over there? Yeah? That guy over there is Jesus. No, I'm telling you, it can't be Jesus. He was just killed not long ago. No, I'm telling you, it's him. Jesus is dead. The Romans killed him. They know how to kill people. It's Jesus. Look, they put a spear in his side. Blood and water came out. They crucified him. He's dead. It's Jesus. It can't be. It is. How do you know? The women told me. They're not making this up. There's even potentially embarrassing details about Jesus in there. Jesus is considered out of his mind by his own family who come to seize him and take him home. This is in Mark chapter 3. His own family thinks he's nuts. Now, you may have heard the scholars say the New Testament writers embellish Jesus to be God. Really? Then why is Mark chapter 3 in there, which is almost universally recognized to be the earliest gospel? Why are they doubting that Jesus is of a sane mind if they're making this up? Also, Jesus is called a drunkard. He's called demon-possessed. That's real flattering, isn't it? In fact, one of his women witnesses was demon-possessed, formerly demon-possessed. What a great witness, isn't it? He has his feet wiped with the hair of a prostitute, which easily could have been seen as a sexual advance. And oh, by the way, notice there are two prostitutes in Jesus' bloodline. This is the Messiah's bloodline. Who are they? Rahab and Tamar. Do you think Matthew and Luke got together and said, you know what, I really think we ought to spice up the Messiah's bloodline a little bit. Let's put a couple of prostitutes in there, Rahab, Tamar. No, that's embarrassing. In fact, it's not just the prostitutes that are embarrassing. Think of other people in the bloodline, like Judah, where we get the term Jew from. Whew, not a good guy. Read about him in Genesis. David, a man after God's own heart. Yeah, but he's a liar, adulterer, and a murderer. Gee, I guess there's hope for the rest of us then, huh? This guy's after God's own heart? Bathsheba's in the bloodline. You know when Matthew gets to Bathsheba in the genealogy, he won't mention her name. You know what he says instead? Uriah's wife. Ooh. That's a slam, right? But he's telling the truth. Who is Uriah? Husband of Bathsheba, whom David had killed so he could have Bathsheba. This is not an invented bloodline. It's got a lot of shady characters in it. The Pharaoh in Egypt would never tolerate such a thing. When the historian says, hey, Pharaoh, I'm going to put a couple of prostitutes and some real shady characters in your genealogy. What's the Pharaoh going to say? Off with your head. No, the Bible is the ultimate no-spin zone. It tells you all the evil that all of the supposed heroes have done. It's embarrassing, but true. Last one, excruciating deaths. This is the argument that says that these men who were in a position to know whether Jesus had risen from the dead or not died excruciating deaths when they simply could have saved themselves by saying it never happened. Now, it's really important to realize that the people who wrote the New Testament down were Jewish believers in Yahweh. They already thought they were God's chosen people. They didn't believe somebody could claim to be God. That would be blasphemy. And they didn't believe somebody in the middle of time would resurrect. They believed there'd be a resurrection at the end of time, but not in the middle. Why would they invent such a story? Being already Jewish believers in Yahweh, God's chosen people. What did the New Testament writers have to gain by making up a new religion? What did they get? They got kicked out of the synagogue, and then they got beaten, tortured, and killed. Last time I checked, that was not a list of perks. We're going to start a new religion. We are? Yeah. What's it going to get us? First, we get kicked out of the synagogue, then beaten, tortured, and killed. Well, sign me up. You know, what a great idea. No, I don't think so. In fact, they had every motive to say the resurrection did not happen, not every motive to say it did. I get this question a lot. Maybe you do if you're a Christian. Are there any non-Christian writers that talk about Jesus and the apostles? I mentioned them earlier just briefly. They're not eyewitnesses, but they give the same basic story. But you know what is sort of underneath that question? An illicit assumption. Here's the illicit assumption. You really can't trust the New Testament writers because, you see, these were religious people. We know religious people embellish things. They make things up. If you think about that for more than 10 seconds, you realize how stupid that objection is. Why? What motive did these people have to gain to make up a new religion? Nothing. They had every motive to say it wasn't true, not every motive to say it was true. My friend J. Warner Wallace, who you may have seen on Dateline a number of times, has written a book called Cold Case Christianity. He also has a brand new great book called Person of Interest You Need to Get. Anyway, Jim has been on Dateline more than any other cold case detective because he solves murders decades old. And he says that whenever he finds a dead body, he knows that that guy is dead, if it was murdered, for one or of three reasons, or a combination of the three reasons. He says, not 1,000 reasons why that guy's dead. It's one of these three or a combination of the three. There was either a sex issue, a money issue, or a power issue. Sex, money, or power. That's why people commit crimes. That's why you and I sin, because sex, money, and power are good things. In fact, they're so good, we'll sometimes take shortcuts to get them. So if you're going to say that they made all this up, that they invented this, you have to find one or more of those motivators for them to say, yeah, okay, maybe they did make it up to get sex, money, or power. Question, ladies and gentlemen, did the writers of the New Testament get real popular with the ladies for saying Jesus had resurrected from the dead? No. Did they get rich by saying Jesus rose from the dead? No, they weren't 21st century prosperity gospel preachers. Okay? Did they get power by saying Jesus had resurrected from the dead? No, they got persecuted, the opposite. Paul had power as a persecutor. As soon as he becomes a Christian, what happens? He gets persecuted. They had no motive to make this up. They had every motive to say it didn't happen, not every motive to say it did. And then why would they die for a known lie? You say, wait a minute, Frank, time out. If you're going to tell me that martyrdom proves Christianity, don't you have to say that martyrdom proves Islam? No, why? Because there's a lot of differences between the Muslim martyrs of today and the New Testament martyrs of New Testament times. But let me just give you one big difference for our purposes here. The Muslim martyrs haven't witnessed anything that tells them that Islam is true. They just have faith. The New Testament martyrs, on the other hand, witness Jesus rise from the dead. They saw Jesus. They touched Jesus. They ate with Jesus. They verified with their own senses that Jesus had risen from the dead. Many people will die for a lie they think is the truth. Nobody will die for a lie they know is a lie. And the New Testament writers were in a position to know whether it was a lie or not, and they went to their deaths anyway. You can't get better evidence than that unless you were there yourself. All right, what I'm about to say to wrap this New Testament section up is something that's going to annoy a lot of people in here. Sorry. If you believe like I do that the Bible's inerrant, it's going to annoy you for a minute, but stick with me. It's going to sound like heresy, but it's not. Christianity is not true because a series of documents we put under one binding we call the Bible says it's true. In fact, Christianity would be true if the Bible never existed. How can that be? Because Christianity did not originate with a book. Christianity originated with an event, the resurrection. Do you realize there were thousands of Christians before a line of the New Testament was ever written? Was Paul a Christian before he wrote the book of Romans? Of course he was. That's why he wrote the book of Romans. Because Jesus had appeared to him. Was Matthew a Christian before he wrote the Gospel of Matthew? Of course he was. That's why he wrote the Gospel of Matthew. In other words, we could put it this way. The New Testament writers did not create the resurrection. The resurrection created the New Testament writers. You wouldn't even have a New Testament or New Testament documents written down by Jewish believers in Yahweh in the first century unless Jesus rose from the dead. Why would they do it? They wouldn't. It's not an invented storyline. Now, thankfully, they did write it down so we could know about it and orient our lives toward it. But it would be true even if they had never said a word about it. Because it originated with an event, not a book. All right? Now, there's more, but we don't have time to go into it. Here's the overall argument again. Does truth exist? The answer is, if somebody says there's no truth, you're going to say, is that true? Does God exist? First argument, cosmological. Second, teleological. Third, moral. You get the attributes of God from those three arguments. Are miracles possible? What's the greatest miracle in the Bible? Creation, first verse of the Bible. Is the New Testament telling the truth about the resurrection? Yeah, it sure seems so. Why would they invent it? Doesn't make any sense they would. If you want to go further, the books and the DVDs are back there. There's that word again. Text it, evidence, to 44222. Don't put quotes on it, just the word evidence. We're now teaching online courses If you go to our website, crossexamine.org, click on online courses, you'll see them. In fact, Sean McDowell is about to teach one on the LGBTQ issue you may be interested in. It starts this week. Also, we're on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. This is being streamed on YouTube and Twitter right now, and Facebook, not Twitter, but and Instagram, I think. In fact, we're so into YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook, we've actually combined these three into one social media platform. We call it YouTwitface. Have you guys signed up for YouTwitface yet? It's kind of a Jersey thing. You ought to do it. Don't forget the podcast. It's called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. Don't forget the TV show on Wednesday night, and it's also streaming on our app. If you don't do anything else, download this cross-examined app, two words in the app store. It's got the podcast on there. It's got the TV show on there. It has a quick answer section on there. Anytime we go live, you'll get a notification if you want to see any kind of presentation. So check all that out. So before we get to your questions, it's true. The question is, so what if it's true? But what if it's true? Someone actually did die for you. Now, when I was in the Navy, I was in naval aviation, so we had to earn wings, which were fairly hard to earn. But there's nothing more difficult in any service, certainly not the Navy, to earn than a golden trident. That's what the SEALs wear. Very few people that start SEAL training make it through. Maybe 5, 10% make it through. Those that do make it through wear that trident with pride. It is their identity. When Michael Monsor was buried in Rosecrans Cemetery just outside of San Diego, California, just about every Navy SEAL on the West Coast showed up for his funeral. And when they passed his casket, they took off their tridents and they pressed them into his casket. They took their identity and they put their identity in the one that died for them, the one that sacrificed for them. That's what we're supposed to do. But our culture says, no, put your identity in your political party, or put your identity in your ethnic group, or put your identity in your race. There's only one race, the human race. Or put your identity in your sexual orientation, or your boyfriend, or your girlfriend, or your major, or your bank account, or your vocation. None of those things are ultimate, ladies and gentlemen. We were here to put our identity in our Savior. And we would all be foolish if this is really true to not do that. You know, Christianity is the only worldview where you don't achieve your identity. You receive your identity, and you can't lose it. If you have to achieve your identity, all the pressure's on you. You got to perform. And somebody can always do it better than you, can't they? Somebody's always better. Somebody's always prettier. Somebody's always more handsome. Somebody's always more skilled. Somebody always has the better spouse. No. You get your identity from your Savior. And an eyewitness who was with Jesus, who wrote a biography we call the Gospel of John, said, He has given you the right to become a child of God. Why do you need that? Because you've fallen short, I've fallen short. Why wouldn't you accept the free gift of grace? That's what Christianity is all about. It's grace. It's not do this and do that. It's done. All you need to do is accept it. Why wouldn't you do that? He didn't just die, by the way. He also rose again. And that means one day you and I will rise again too. The only question is to where. All right. It's time for questions. And so the great Clint Bolin here, who is video extraordinaire, is going to set up a microphone, and you need to, if you want to ask a question, come up to the mic, because the people online will not be able to hear you if you don't come up to the mic. And since no one likes to ask the first question, let's move right on to the second question. So, and you can line up behind him, and while you do that, if you would take a shot of this with your cell phone, you can give us some feedback on the event, and also you can get some information if you want to follow up, because there are several Christian groups here, including H2O Church and several others, that can minister to you if you're interested. All right. Yes, sir. Give us your name again, all right. Sir.
Cade. With Ratio Christi Ministries.
Yes, sir. Reason for Christ.
Yes. Yes, in Latin. This is from Dennis Hess. He's in Williamsburg, Virginia.
I know Dennis. Hey, okay. Dennis.
Okay. He says hi.
Mm-hmm.
So he's in Williamsburg, Virginia. He says, ask him this question. There is talk about 777 books of the Bible, and that the church, I guess he's talking about the Catholic Church, he says that in parentheses, is hiding these books in the Vatican. I'm not talking about the known books not in the canon. Can he shed any light on the veracity of this claim?
Well, when somebody makes a claim like that, it's not your job or my job to refute the claim. It's that person's job to support the claim. Mm-hmm. So I haven't heard that claim. If somebody had evidence, I'd ask them, what evidence do you have for that? And what people need to understand is the Catholic Church did not have a stranglehold on the manuscripts that were written down, because there was no such thing as an organized Catholic Church for about 300 years. And the New Testament manuscripts predate that by centuries, as you know. So to say that the Catholic Church, I don't know what evidence somebody would bring forth, but just off the top of my head, I would say, how can that be that somehow the Catholic Church gathered all these manuscripts up of other biblical books and nobody else knows about them until now, and they're hidden in some vault somewhere? That just doesn't seem to make any sense. Yeah. It's like trying to change a manuscript. You can't change all the manuscripts because they're spread all over the ancient world. So in order to change what the Bible says, you'd have to hunt down every single manuscript and change every single one of them. Can't be done. All right?
Cool.
All right. Yep. Thanks, Kate.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hi,
take the mask down if you could. All What's right. your name?
My name is Peter.
Hey, Peter. How are you?
Not too bad. You were talking about the cosmological argument for the existence of God, that the universe has to have a creator. But does the existence of a creator cause problems of itself when it comes to the origin of that creator? Especially considering a creator of the universe would likely be more complex than the universe itself, and then less likely to come into existence than the universe itself by itself.
Okay, good question. But what do you mean by more complex?
I would say that it would have to be like a, this is kind of like piggybacking off of the watchmaker argument, that there would have to be a watchmaker to create a watch, thus
right.
it would be that the, hard to really define, more complex, but.
I see where you're going with this. Let me see if I can see where you're coming from. This is from Richard Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, where he talks about, well, if the universe is complex, there must be a being more complex that created that, okay? But it depends on what he means by complex, because as Christians or as theists in general, we don't believe that God is complex in the sense that he's made of parts, because anything made of parts is composed. And if it's composed, there must be something outside that being that composed it. So when we talk about God being simple, what we mean is he doesn't have parts, but he still has power. He's an unembodied mind, we might say. So he doesn't have all these gears and complexities that we think of created physical things. He's an immaterial, powerful being. And when you look at the evidence for the beginning of the universe, it seems if space, time, and matter had a beginning, then the cause must be spaceless, timeless. If you're timeless, do you have a beginning?
No.
So this being didn't have a beginning. This is the unmoved mover, as Aristotle would say. The being is also immaterial. He's personal. He's intelligent. He's powerful, as we mentioned earlier. So it really hinges on what the word complex means. Powerful, yes, but not complex in the sense that he's composed of parts. He's an immaterial being that had no beginning and will have no end. All of us and everything we see that's physical had a beginning and is composed, which means something outside of it must have composed it. In fact, that's another argument for God, Peter, is that everything that's composed needs a composer, but you can't go on an infinite regress of composers. Eventually, you're going to have to get back to an uncomposed composer. And that's what Aristotle would call the unmoved mover. That's what the Bible calls the great I am, the being that is self-existing and eternal. Does that make sense?
Do you mind if I add on?
Sure, go ahead. Go.
Would it be simpler to assume that a lot of those traits that you use describing God could be used to just describe the universe we're in and be a simpler explanation for our existence?
Well, the universe we're in appears to have a beginning
yes.
from nothing. So it would seem that the cause must transcend space, time, and matter. So the cause can't be the universe because the universe is the effect. And you can't create yourself. So there must be something that transcends the universe. And not only was it created, it seems, but created in a very fine-tuned way, as we saw earlier. So it appears to be the product of intelligence, a mind. And that's the best we can do at this point.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Peter. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name is Lyndon.
Hey, Lyndon. Get a little closer, if you would, to the microphone, Lyndon. Thank you.
Some have proposed, in order to refute the argument for the complexity of the universe and its fine-tuning, that perhaps infinite, all possible universes exist, and thus we just happen to be in the one that could support life to see it. Could you mm-hmm. respond to multiverse hypothesis?
Yeah, sure. The multiverse hypothesis is relatively new, and really what it is a response to the fact that the universe appears to be so designed. Nobody would be thinking that there are other universes out there unless they realize, wow, this place is so designed, we've got to multiply our chances that this could have happened without intelligence if we're going to say there's no God. In fact, Paul Davies, who teaches at Arizona State University, who is a cosmologist, he's an agnostic. He doesn't know whether God exists or not, but he says the multiverse is a dodge. They're trying to avoid the obvious implication that the universe had a beginning by it appears to be a beginner. Now, here are some problems with the multiverse, and this is all in the book, by the way. First of all, there's no evidence for it. It's purely speculative. We can't observe any of these universes. We have no way of knowing if they exist because we can only see our universe. Secondly, multiple universes would seem to multiply the need for a creator because each one would need creation to get started. And as Vilenkin, Boot, and Guth found in their theory, which has been verified, even a multiverse needs an absolute beginning. So the Vilenkin-Bohr-Guth theorem, it's called, shows that space, time, and matter had to have an absolute beginning. And even Vilenkin, this guy right here I quoted earlier, who has the book called Many Worlds in One from 2006, who believes that there maybe are other universes out there, even he admits, even if he's right, the whole show needs an absolute beginning. So it doesn't really seem to get rid of the problem that atheists are trying to avoid. You might ask, who or what is producing these universes and keeping them from colliding? This multiplies causes beyond necessity. You've probably heard of Occam's razor, where you're supposed to take you're not supposed to multiply causes when a simpler cause could be just a single creator rather than all these multiple universes out there. And then finally, this is an atheist admission of evidence for design and the fact that design can be detected. That's why they're coming up with this theory, because they're saying, really, it really does look like design. Even though on one hand they're saying it looks like it's design, on the other hand they're saying, well, design isn't science. Well, you can't have it both ways, all right? Does that make sense? All right, thank you. Yes, sir.
Hey, doctor.
Hey, Jake.
My name's Jake.
Hey, Jake.
Yeah, long time no see.
Yeah, thank you. Go ahead.
Hey, so I want to preface my question by saying I'm a fan of yours. I've read your books, watched your debates and Q&A videos, all that. I think most of the work you do is spectacular, so.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Fighting the good fight. Thank you. So I'm not a student here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the director of a Latino mission and ministry and church here in Cincinnati.
Okay.
So naturally part of my job is evangelism
mm-hmm.
and using apologetics. So from my perspective as a minister to the Latino Spanish-speaking mm-hmm. demographic, what are you and your ministry doing to further your outreach to that population?
Well, our executive director, Jorge Gill, who's out there right now, hey, Jorge, is really pushing that approach because he's bilingual, and we have several people on our team are bilingual.
Great.
So we have a course called Why I Still Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist in Spanish. We have the Stealing from God course in Spanish, and we're starting to develop other courses in Espanol as well.
Great.
And also, we're about to establish an international YouTube channel with all different languages on it.
Oh, wow.
And Jorge has a show, a Spanish show, that he does about twice a week. Mm-hmm. If you go to Jorge Gill, if you go to his Instagram page, or he may be doing it on our YouTube channel as well, mm-hmm. We have a Spanish version of the YouTube channel. You can see it there.
Great, thanks. And one more quick question, mm-hmm. if you don't mind. I know it's cliche, and it's cliche to say it's cliche, but if you had to give one piece of advice to a young minister such as myself, what would you say?
A minister, or are you talking about advice on apologetics? What do you mean?
Either way.
I think that we as apologists have to major in the majors and not major in the minors. In other words, stay on the big issues like truth, God, miracles, New Testament. We can argue amongst ourselves over other questions. A lot of people want to talk about how old the universe is, and I always say I'm absolutely convinced it's at least 59 years old. We can argue about what eschatological view we take, right? We can argue about some harmonizations of Scripture, you know, is this a contradiction or just a difference? We can argue over many secondary and tertiary issues. We need to stay focused on the essentials, because if God exists and Jesus rose from the dead, game over, Christianity's true. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, it's false.
Amen.
All right?
Thank you, Doctor. Stay safe. God bless.
Thank you. Thank you, Jake. Appreciate it. Phillips.
All right. My name is Phillips. I had an atheist friend that was here. He had to duck out early, so he wanted me to ask this question. It was basically, can you define evolution and what's your opinion on it?
Define evolution?
Yeah.
Well, I would ask him, what does he mean by evolution? If he means change over time, count me in. If he means adaptation within a type, microevolution, count me in. If he means molecules to man without intelligent intervention, count me out. I not only think there's not good evidence for that, there's evidence against that. In fact, let me just point out, this is what happened just a few years ago in England. There's a very august scientific affiliation called the Royal Society. And they had this meeting in 2016, and here was the premise of the meeting: that developments in evolutionary biology and adjacent fields have produced calls for revision of the standard theory of evolution, although the issues involved remain hotly contested. In fact, people have realized in recent decades that DNA is not destiny, that you can't mutate DNA and get a new body plan. You need epigenetic information, which is the structure of the cell, to get a new body plan, and you can't mutate that. So these are the evolutionists who are calling this meeting. These aren't intelligent design people. These are the evolutionists saying, look, our plan isn't working, or our theory isn't working. We need to come up with another theory, another naturalistic theory. Now, they had this meeting. They didn't come to any conclusions, but they're admitting the problem. The problem is that you can't just mutate DNA and get a new body plan. It doesn't work.
That's good. I have a personal question as well. It's just, you mentioned about the fact that we had to have all the stars and whatnot in the universe for us to exist. Can you explain more in detail why that is, outside of just Jupiter being the cosmic vacuum?
Well, I said that there has to be 30 trillion miles of distance between the stars and our galaxy for us to exist here on Earth. If the distances were different, the gravitational forces would not allow us to remain in a stable orbit, as I understand that particular, what we call anthropic principle there. Okay. Now, I'm relying on other scientists for that. I'm just repeating what they're saying. But that distance is necessary for us to exist here in a stable orbit around our sun. If those distances were different, we wouldn't do that.
Wow. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Phillips. Gentlemen. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Jack.
Hey, Jack. How are you?
Doing well. First off, I want to say something that might be a little bit controversial here.
That's okay. We love controversy.
I'm blind, so I think I have that privilege.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Attack today. Go Bulldogs. We're number one. Not Cincinnati. Just want to get that out there. Just want to get that out there. So my question was about the arguments for evil being a shadow of good, essentially.
Yeah.
Like, I understand the basic idea with that. Is there a more philosophically rigorous way of proving that evil is a shadow instead of good being the shadow? I mean, there are all these analogies about cancer out of the body, rust out of the car, but that doesn't really prove anything. Is there a philosophically rigorous way to show that evil is a shadow of good instead of the other way around?
Well, let's take someone like Satan, okay? Mm-hmm. We think Satan is evil, right? Mm-hmm. And he is. But metaphysically, he's not evil.
meaning that he has good qualities. What are the good qualities? He has mind, emotion, and will. Those are all good. And he uses them to do evil. Even Hitler, we look at Hitler. He had mind, emotion, and will. And what was Hitler trying to do, according to him? He was trying to do something good. Mm-hmm. He was trying to create the super race. And in order to do that, he thought that he had to take, he had to get rid of the undesirables, the lower levels of life, because according to Darwin's theory, they were lower levels. And if we want to increase our evolution toward a higher level, we've got to get rid of those people and take their resources and use them to create the Aryan race. Thanos! He wants to get rid of half the population, right? Why? Because he's trying to, what he thinks is to do a good thing. Do we have any superhero fans in here? Okay. Yeah. Tyrants are always trying to do good things by claiming that it's a good end and you're just going to have to deal with the means. So you can't think of the other way around. You very rarely do, you, any of us, we rarely do evil for evil's sake. We're always doing evil to get a good thing, right? Sex, money, and power are good things. That's why we do evil. We don't do evil to try and get an evil thing. We do evil to try and get a good thing. And if you read, by the way, C.S. Lewis's book on this, Jack, well, it's not on this, but on Mere Christianity, he talks about how dualism can't be the truth. Because if you think about it, Satan is called a fallen angel, right? He has good qualities, but now he's using them for evil, and the evil that he does gets him good things. Mm-hmm.
So a couple weeks ago, an unbelievable, I was listening to a debate between two philosophers, and the one was positing that it could be that our conception is twisted, and that God himself, or the supreme being,
hey, Jack, do me a favor. Just move to your right half a step.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Say it again. Unbelievable. Go ahead.
Unbelievable, the show with Justin Brierley. A few weeks ago, there was a debate between two philosophers, and the atheist philosopher posited that maybe the supreme being in the universe is actually a force for evil as opposed to being good.
You see, I can't see how that can be, because you wouldn't even know what evil was unless you knew what good was, right? You wouldn't know what a immoral being was unless you knew what a moral being was. You could know what morality was in the absence of immorality, but you can't know immorality unless you know what morality is.
Okay, thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Jack. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Hello. My name is Jared.
Jared?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Jared.
Big fan. Also, I just wanted to ask, so on like the argument of how, you know, it's just insane how Earth came to be, you know, perfectly aligned with all the other planets and, you know, human life coming to be, DNA, like all that, just completely insane how all that works. Couldn't you say, though, since, you know, the universe or space itself is constantly expanding, that out of sheer luck we could have just been made through, well, luck?
Well, that's one of the things that Richard Dawkins says in his book, The God Delusion. He talks about luck. And I'm reading Dawkins going, you're supposed to be a scientist? What's luck? Right? Yeah. Luck is not a cause. Just like chance, it's not a cause. So I ask you, what do you mean by luck? Luck doesn't cause anything. Let me give you an example. Let's suppose I take out a coin. And, you know, we're about to pick sides or something on a team. And, you know, heads, I win. You know, tails, you win. Mm-hmm. And I flip the coin, what's causing it to come up heads or tails? Is it luck or is it something else?
Chance?
No, it's not chance. It's how much force I put on it, what the wind is in the room, how high off the ground I am, how it started in my... If we could figure out all of those forces to absolute precision, we could tell with 100% certainty how that thing's gonna land. Because luck or chance doesn't do anything. We just use luck or chance to cover our ignorance when we can't calculate all those forces.
Very true. Okay.
All right.
That answers it.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hey, by the way, before we move on, folks, if you could give us some feedback by taking a survey, text the word event to this number, and we're gonna ask you three questions. And you can just give us some feedback so we can improve what we're doing here. Yes, sir, what's your name?
Hi, I'm Chase. Just quickly want to say thanks for doing what you do.
Thank you, sir.
You make a big impact on a lot of people's hearts and minds, so thank you for being faithful to what the Lord has called you to do.
Thank you.
Since you haven't said anything remotely controversial, I'd like to get into something a little bit off of the presentation.
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask about your views on women as pastors, elders, leaders in the church, what your thoughts are, but also, more than that, what resources you would direct myself and others to so we can better research and understand gender roles as they pertain to the church. Quickly, in 2 Timothy and 2 Corinthians, we see what Paul says about women remaining quiet during church services. But then we also see, as you mentioned, women were the first to see Jesus after he was resurrected. Then we see Junia, Priscilla, and Lydia mentioned by Paul as having some sort of authoritative standing in the church, yet he also writes in 2 Timothy and 2 Corinthians about how women should not have authority over men and teach. It's something I'm working through theologically. I want to make sure that I understand where the Bible lands on truth, but it just seems a little bit muddy, so I'd like some clarity on how to approach that to understand what is true.
Okay, first of all, men and women are one in under Christ, just like slave and free and Jew and Gentile, you know, Galatians 3:28, we're all one in the eyes of Christ, right? And just like a man and a woman are equally human, God and Jesus are equally divine, but they have different functions, right? Jesus has a different function than the Father. And a woman has a different function in the home than a man, and a different function in the church than a man. It's not because one is better or worse than the other. It's because God has assigned these different roles for a reason. Now, he doesn't always explain what those reasons are, but that's what they are. Now, if you look at 1 Timothy 2, and you look at that other passage in
2 Corinthians.
Yeah, 2 Corinthians. It could be that the passage in 2 Timothy, first of all, the bottom line is, I think that men should be the lead pastor, because I think that's what the text says. But because all the talk about elders and all this is all about men and all this, okay. But that doesn't mean women don't have a ministry. They do. But my friend Greg Kokel at Stand to Reason, many people here know who Greg is. He wrote the book Tactics. He has an article that's very interesting on this passage on women not teaching or not having authority over a man. He thinks that might have to do with the home rather than the church. And if you read I can't recreate his entire argument off the top of my head, but if you go to Stand to Reason and said, should women teach? I think that's the name of it. Just take a look, because the same word that's used for women could be wife. Same word for man could be husband, according to him. I'm no Greek expert. I'm relying on him for that, okay? Also, for these kinds of issues, these theological issues, by the way, these are secondary issues. They're not primary issues, right? There's a great app you can get. It's called Got Questions. I don't know if you've seen that app, but Got Questions. So if you were to type in women in the church there, you're probably going to get 5 or 6 articles that you can read, and I think they do a pretty good job. You might not agree with all of them, but I think they do a pretty good job of laying out the case on each side. So I would recommend
as long as they're biblically
there.
Based, I'm sure all of
them. They are
biblically
based.
For me, it's a matter of exegetically looking at what the text says, understanding what Paul's intention was. Because if he meant wife when he wrote it in the original language, and then it just says women now, I want to understand what it meant originally. But no, that's helpful. Thank
you. Okay. All right. Cool. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Adam.
What's your name?
Adam.
Hey, Adam, go ahead, sir.
So I was debating an internet atheist on TikTok.
Uh-huh.
And he asked me these questions. I just want to
go ahead.
Ask you, because you probably give a better answer. He asked, how can nothing exist?
How can what?
How can nothing exist?
Well, he's assuming nothing is something. You want to ask him, what do you mean by nothing? Mm. Because like, if I were to say to you, Adam, I had nothing for lunch today, do you think I went down to a restaurant and ordered a plate of nothing? No. You know what I meant. I didn't eat lunch today. It's non-being. It's not a being called nothing. And this is what I think a lot of atheists have unfortunately tried to confuse what nothing is, like Lawrence Krauss, the guy I mentioned earlier. He tried to say nothing is actually a quantum vacuum, which isn't nothing. It's something which needs creation itself. So I would ask him, what do you mean by nothing? What we mean by nothing is non-being. It's not something called nothing, it's non-being. No thing.
And I have one more question.
Sure. What rocks dream about, as Aristotle said. Okay.
How can I prove disorder cannot create order and intelligence?
How can I prove that disorder cannot create order and intelligence?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it depends on what he means by proof, but there is nothing more set in science than thermodynamics. It's virtually a closed science. The second law of thermodynamics says that things go to disorder, not order. And all scientists agree that ultimately this whole universe is going to go to disorder, that we're going to go to heat death. So forget about eternal life here unless God steps in and recreates everything. We're ultimately going to all go to heat death. See, the second law of thermodynamics says things are going to disorder, meaning, for example, that nature will take a building and turn it into a pile of bricks, but nature will never take a pile of bricks and turn it into a building. And the problem with macroevolution and the atheistic viewpoint is they're trying to build everything from the bottom up with natural laws. And natural laws don't do that. Natural laws go to disorder, not order. Now, an astute evolutionist would say, well, we don't talk about the beginning of the universe. I'm sorry, the beginning of life. We don't know what created life. But we're saying subsequent life forms can get more and more complex. And it is true that we get more complex as we grow, right? We're taking energy from the outside and we're growing. That's true, but you have to have a life form first to do that. You also need a universe, a fine-tuned universe, before you can ever get life. So it multiplies problems for the atheist, and there are several other problems with the macroevolutionary theory, including irreducible complexity, epigenetic information I just briefly mentioned ago, the fact that we run into genetic limits to change, that even using our minds, we can't break genetic limits. You know that breeders can breed all different kinds of dogs, but they can't break out of the dog genus, right? And if you're using your mind and you can't break out of the dog genus, why do we think we can break out of the dog genus with an unintelligent process? And last thing I'll say on this is that even if macroevolution were true, it wouldn't get rid of the need for God. Why? Because macroevolution explains one out of maybe 10 different things that need to be explained. You need to explain where the universe came from, why it's fine-tuned. You need to explain where life came from. You need to explain the origin of consciousness, the origin of mathematics, the origin of morality, the origin of several other things that can't be explained just by the natural laws themselves, for example. Where do natural laws come from? That's driving all this stuff. Laws come from lawgivers. So even if the macroevolutionary worldview were true in the sense that they could figure out how subsequent life forms could come into existence, it wouldn't do anything to get rid of the need for God.
God bless you.
All right, thanks, Adam. Appreciate it, man. Yes, sir. Take off that mask if you could, man. So,
yeah.
What's your name?
Trey.
Trey, go ahead, sir.
First, I'd like to say that I'm a Christian and I've been following you for the past 2 years.
So oh, thanks, brother.
Really helped me strengthen
you and my
faith.
Mom. Go ahead.
Okay, so am I allowed to ask you two questions?
Hi, Mom. She's watching. Yeah, go ahead, sir.
All right. So my first question is in regard to the Old Testament.
Yes, sir.
There are many scholars of the ancient Near East, Egyptology, and the Hebrew Bible who claim that archaeological evidence debunks many of the historical events and people in the Old Testament. Is there an apologetic defense to such claims?
They're claiming that there is not evidence for people in the Old Testament?
They're saying that archaeological evidence from different ancient events, say, for instance, like in the Bible, for instance, like in Joshua, when the Israelites went into Jericho, they say that there's no evidence of a battle between the Israelites and Jericho, and they try and say, well, that disproves that event from happening in the Bible.
Okay, wait. Yeah, first of all, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
And there is evidence at Jericho that the walls fell oddly outward.
Okay.
And Bryant Wood has done the investigation on that. And now that you mention it, let's just look at just a few people that have been discovered in the Old Testament. Do you see? These are obscure people in the Old Testament. These are seals that were discovered in Jerusalem, in the city of David, which is off the southern wall of the current city of Jerusalem. This was Jerusalem in David's day. Do you see all these names?
Yeah, those are
kings. Uzzah and Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Ezekiel. These these are, or Hezekiah, these are all seals of these people that have been found in the dirt. I mean, these are real people. Right. Now, this doesn't prove that everything the Bible says that these folks did, they did, but it does show that these people, it seems, existed.
Right.
Some of these are really odd names. Some of these people, I can't remember who they are, but like this guy down here.
Those are kings. From
well, some of them are kings, but some of them are scribes for Jeremiah. Mm-hmm. And they're mentioned once or twice in Jeremiah. And these seals have been unearthed with their names on it. Even, I think Isaiah's up. Is Isaiah up here? Isaiah may not be up here, but I think they may have found an Isaiah seal too, if I'm not mistaken. So here's a book to get, Unearthing the Bible by Titus Kennedy. Titus Kennedy. Titus Kennedy's a real-life Indiana Jones, okay? Titus Kennedy himself, back in 2018, I think it was, went to the Sudan, which was not a place you wanted to go, because he needed to verify an inscription of Yahweh, the oldest inscription of Yahweh found anywhere in the world. He needed to verify it. So he flew to Sudan and then slept with the scorpions trying to get to this one obscure location, and did verify this inscription from Yahweh, about Yahweh, from 1400 BC, exactly the time that the Israelites would have left Egypt. And this was Egypt at the time of the Exodus, this part of Sudan. And that's the oldest discovery, inscription of Yahweh discovered anywhere in the world, and it's discovered in Egypt. And in his book, Unearthing the Bible, he'll have that with pictures and many other discoveries. So check that out.
Okay. And I have one last question.
Yes, sir.
There are also many that say that Christianity stole religious concepts from other ancient civilizations, such as the Achaemenid Persian king's title of King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the dying and resurrecting God from Egypt, as well as the Roman emperor being the son of God. How do we as Christians get around such claims?
Well, you'd have to investigate each one on a case-by-case basis, and it wouldn't be the first time that the Bible uses a phrase from somebody else to say, no, we are the true.
Oh, I get that, yeah.
Right? We are the true. This is the true Son of God. You think Caesar's the Son of God? No, Jesus is really the Son of God. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that it's false. It means it's a modern-day polemic. In fact, this is what I think maybe Genesis 1 is about. Because, look, Genesis 1 is written by Moses, and the people had just come out of 400 years of slavery in Egypt. They're walking through the desert. When they're walking through the desert, they're not going, I wonder how old this place is, right? That's not the question they're asking. Mm-hmm. They're wondering, is Yahweh the true God, or are the gods of Egypt the true gods?
Right.
Well, if you look at the Egyptian creation story, in the Egyptian creation story, their gods are somehow already in the world, and then they somehow bring order to the chaos. Whereas the Hebrew creation story is, no. God is outside the universe. He creates the universe, and he brings order to the chaos. He doesn't even have to fight with anyone. He's the true God.
Right.
So it seems the way that was written, Genesis 1, was a polemic against the Egyptian creation story. All right.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Trey.
Can I move this down?
Yeah, you can just bend it down a little bit. What's your name?
My name's Jackson.
Jackson, go ahead, sir.
Now I forgot my question. Okay, I got it. If there are other universes, mm-hmm. what was the point of making them? Because, like, assuming we are the only civilized people.
Oh, you're talking about other galaxies?
Other galaxies, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, let me ask you a question. If the universe ended at the cloud tops, mm-hmm. we'd probably look up and go, this isn't any big deal, right? But when we look out and we realize that the number of stars out there are equivalent to sand grains on 100,000 Earths, we're starting to get the majesty of what the Creator is like. Because we know God by his effects. We can't know God directly. I mean, try and think of something infinite. It's hard to think. You can't do that. But you can think about a finite thing that's really big, like the universe, and get some kind of analogous idea to what the infinite might be. And I think that's why God, one reason God created such a vast universe, because he says, look to the heavens if you want to know what I'm like. Look to the heavens. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I have one more question.
Go ahead, Jackson.
How would you go about, well, I have a friend who is not a Christian.
Uh-huh.
And his whole argument is God doesn't know the things that I've done. So how would you go?
God doesn't what?
God doesn't know the things that I've done, so therefore he can't be real.
God doesn't know. I would ask him, how does he know God doesn't know?
that's what I said to him. And
right.
It was just really like...
You see, because if God is outside of time, mm-hmm. he sees the end from the beginning all at once. He knows everything that your friend has done and everything mm-hmm. he will do, just like he knows everything you will do, but you're still doing it freely. And so if that being does exist and he's just, which he is, there's going to be a judgment. Mm-hmm. So why would you want to be judged when you could be pardoned because somebody else took the punishment for you? Jesus did. Right?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you want that? Why wouldn't anyone want that, do you think? Mm-hmm. Why is he not wanting to be a Christian?
I'm thinking it has something to do with accountability.
Probably. You're probably right. So ask him, if Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? What do you think he would say?
He'd probably say, I mean, if it was true, but then, then he'd be like,
yeah,
probably not.
Yeah, just say, if it was true, would you become a Christian?
He'd probably say yes, but it's not true.
Oh, well, he doesn't sound too open then, does he?
Yeah.
See, what you might say to him, well, why don't we investigate it together? Why don't we go through the evidence together? Would you do that? Mm-hmm. See what he says.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
Thanks, Jackson.
Thanks
for caring about your friend, too. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm George.
Hey, George. Turn that up just a little bit.
Oh, right here?
Yeah, there you go. Okay. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Can I say hi to my mom?
Please, yeah.
Hi, Mom.
Oh, she's right over here.
Hi, Mom.
Okay.
I don't know which camera, okay, that's why. Anyways, I've been following you for quite a while now, and I really got to thank you, Frank, because of you, I really upstarted in my journey in apologetics, and now I'm just a big nerd in philosophy, theology, and history. So,
good.
Anyway, I guess my question is that I've been looking into a lot of the arguments, like the kalam, contingency, and the moral arguments, and like those are all my favorite. But I think the one argument that I've been kind of getting interested in,
mm-hmm.
That I find like really fascinating, is the problem of induction. Like from what I understand, is basically the problem of like. In an atheistic worldview where they can't really justify the inductive reasoning of basically the uniformity in nature and mm-hmm. how they propose that, what's a better word? I think the question that was proposed by Bertrand Russell, David Hume, how they can't really justify inductive reasoning. So I guess my question is, it's just like, do you have any resources or any books like you recommend that kind of dives deep into that or...
On inductive reasoning?
Yeah. Well, problem of induction.
What is their problem of induction?
Basically just like proposing that the uniformity in nature,
mm-hmm.
Where they kind of hinge on it, but through an atheistic worldview, there's no justifiable reason from what I understand. I mean, is this something that you
kind of
familiar
with?
Yeah,
what you're speaking of in the uniformity of nature is that in order for us to understand what happened in the past, we have to assume the past has worked the same way then as it does now.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If Napoleon comes across the Rosetta Stone mm-hmm. and he sees those three languages in the Rosetta Stone, he immediately knows that had to be an intelligent being because he's assuming that whenever they created the Rosetta Stone, natural laws could not have done that.
Mm.
Right?
Right.
Only intelligence could do that.
Okay.
If we can't assume the principle of uniformity in the past, then we can't get at the past because we weren't there.
Mm.
Right? So we have to assume the laws worked yesterday the way they do today. That's the principle of uniformity.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
And my question for the atheist would be, why is the universe so orderly?
Mm-hmm.
Why did, when we put H2O, that's like a church here too, when we put H2O together, you know, two parts hydrogen, one part oxygen, we got water yesterday. We do it today, we get water again. Mm. If we're here tomorrow, we'll probably get water again. Why is that so consistent? Mm-hmm. Because this universe and the laws that govern it are the product of a mind, an orderer. That's the only way we can do science. Mm-hmm. Because if water didn't form that way yesterday, then and we can't do cause and effect now, we can't do cause and effect later. If everything was chaos, we couldn't discover true cause and effect, could we? So that would be the problem I would present to an atheist. How do you account for the orderliness of the universe? In fact, there was a paper written back in 1961 called The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics by Eugene Wigner. I talk about it in the book Stealing from God, where he basically said, why is this universe so well described by mathematics? Why can we discover how this universe works by math?
Yeah.
And you know what answer he gave, being an atheist? I don't know. But it seems to me it's mathematical because God is mathematical, that his nature is orderly, and that is imposed on its creation.
All right. Do you have any books or resources that?
Well, you can start with Stealing from God, and then I would look into, on science, you might look into Stephen Meyer. You know who Stephen Meyer is?
I've heard of him, yes.
Look at his new book called The God Hypothesis, Return of the God Hypothesis. All right?
All right. Thank you, Frank.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is PK.
Say again?
PK.
PK, go ahead, sir.
So, I'm actually not exactly a Christian right now, but I'd say I'm a freshman in my faith right now.
Okay,
so
good.
I'm growing into it so far. I had a small question, like maybe it might be bouncing off of what you talked about today, but how do you deal when you're angry at God? It says a lot of times, even in Psalm 37, where it says, refrain from anger and forsake wrath, fret not yourself, it tends only to evil. And like me personally, like growing up, the background I came from as well, it talks a lot about like if there's something wrong happening with you or there's something bad that's happened, it's probably your mistake. So God's probably punishing you for doing something that you might have done like maybe in the past or something that you're about to do maybe. That's what you did wrong. That's why you're paying the price for it.
It's kind of a karma view, you mean?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But like when it talks about in Christianity that God is never angry at you. Like there's always grace. He always forgives you. There's no boundaries between you and him once you believe in him completely. But how does it work the opposite way when you know God is such a powerful being? Like there's no one ever closer to him. But how does it work the opposite way when you're the one who's angry at him?
Well, first of all, you can be angry at God because many of the psalmists are angry at God. Like, God, where are you? Why is all this happening? We haven't even been sinning, and things aren't going well, right?
Yeah.
God can handle your emotion. I know this is going to sound weird, but do you know that you can't hurt God by being mad at him, and you can't help him by worshiping him? Right?
That
He's an infinite
sense.
Being. You can't add to an infinite being. You can't take away from an infinite being. So he can handle all your emotions. It's okay to be mad at God. But if you're mad at God, you know what that means? In your mind, God exists. You can't be mad at somebody that doesn't exist, right?
Yeah.
Okay?
That is true.
So God, we get mad at God because our expectations aren't met.
Yeah.
So the question is, what kind of expectations should we expect as a Christian?
Just loving him and like
trusting
him.
And what do we get back from him? We may get discipline. That's Hebrews chapter 12. We may get persecuted. Jesus said that if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. And Paul said, anyone who lives a faithful life in Christ Jesus will get persecuted. We may receive good things too, but all those things can work together for good. Because if things never went wrong for us by our own earthly natures or by our own earthly expectations, we would never grow, would we? I mean, think about if any of us in this room got whatever we wanted every time. If I got whatever I wanted every time, I'd be even more of a moral monster than I already am. I'd become some sort of self-entitled celebrity who would pitch a hissy fit every time my water wasn't at 14.6 degrees, right? You got to have obstacles and difficulty and people saying no in your life. If you don't, you're not going to grow. I mean, think of kids, right? What do we call kids who get everything they want?
Spoiled.
Why are they spoiled?
They get everything.
Because their character's spoiled. If you give a kid everything he or she wants, you're going to ruin them. You need to put boundaries. You need to say no. You need to make things difficult sometimes. So when things aren't going well according to our expectations, God is still at work. And if you read Luke 13, Jesus basically says the tower that fell on the people at Siloam, it killed those 18 people, or the Galileans that Pilate mixed their blood with the sacrifices. He said, do you think those people were worse than you? They were worse sinners than you, and that's why they were killed? He said, no, but unless you repent, the same thing's going to happen to you. In other words, he's not saying that because things go bad, it's because you may have done something evil. Well, maybe you did, and that's why it went bad, but that's not necessarily the reason. There may be 1,000 other reasons that this bad thing has happened, but God can still bring good from it. So it's not a one-to-one relationship that, you know, if you do X, God's going to necessarily do Y. There's something called the ripple effect out there. You know about the ripple effect, right? Yeah. That everything that happens now ripples forward into the future to affect trillions of other things. In fact, if you think about the ripple effect in your own lives, think about all the ripples that needed to take place for you to be alive today. Your parents had to meet. Their parents had to meet. Their parents had to meet. And all those things that caused them to meet had to happen. There's so many ripples out there that we can't keep track of, and of course God can. So when we see a ripple that comes along and we go, or something happens, we go, I can't see any good coming from this. Well, of course we can't. We can see this much of reality. God sees the whole thing. He can see the end from the beginning.
It's an infinite horizon.
Yeah, that's right. But it's okay to be mad at God, but it's not a good long-term strategy.
Hopefully.
Okay,
not.
All right. Hopefully. Just wanted to let you know. All right, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Hey, my name's Logan.
Logan, go ahead, sir.
I'm a Christian, but I just wanted to know how you'd answer.
Get a little closer if you would, Logan. Go ahead.
I want to know how you'd answer the question, why is Christianity the only right religion, and then specifically, why is Islam wrong?
Okay, well, it's not the only right religion, meaning that Christianity has everything right and everybody has everything wrong. Mm. Other world religions have some things right. Islam has right that we ought to pray, we ought to give to the poor. I mean, God does exist. These are all right things. Mm-hmm. But where they differ from Christianity, if Christianity is true, then they're wrong. Why do I not think Islam is true? Because I don't think there's any evidence that Muhammad was a prophet, nor did Muhammad give any evidence he was a prophet. Why? Because Muhammad said, I don't do miracles. I just warn people there's only one God. It's in the Quran it says this. The miracles attributed to Muhammad come much later in the Hadith, the written traditions of what Muhammad said and did, and they were written about 150 years after he's dead. And many of those so-called miracles are obvious ripoffs of the biblical miracles. Like instead of changing water to wine, Muhammad changed water to milk, that kind of stuff, right? Okay. Even many Muslim scholars will say they're not, many of them aren't valid. So I don't think that Islam has given me any reason to say that Christianity is, or Islam is true and Christianity is false. In fact, in Surah 4, verse 157, this is the fourth chapter of the Quran, verse 157, it says that Jesus never died. He was taken straight to heaven. Now, the only people in the world, serious people in the world who study this stuff, who don't believe Jesus was crucified, are the Muslims. Atheistic scholars like Bart Ehrman, they say if there's one established fact from history is Jesus was crucified. Jews believe Jesus was crucified. Christians believe Jesus was crucified. It's only the Muslims that don't believe Jesus was crucified. Why? Because they're getting a so-called revelation 600 plus years later that tells them that, but there's no reason to believe that it's true when you have eyewitnesses from 600 years before that who saw Jesus die and rise again.
Thank you.
All right, thanks. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Hey, my name's Andrew.
Hey, Andrew.
I'm just curious, how do you defend the argument against Christianity that goes something along the lines of the God of the Bible is not worth worshiping because of the atrocities he's committed in the Old Testament?
Okay, first question is, what do you mean by atrocities?
Let's say all the murder or all the people he killed.
The what?
The murder or like him killing people.
Okay, question. When God kills somebody, does he murder them?
I would say no, but I'm saying, like, how do you defend?
Well, that's why I'd ask them. Is God,
When God kills somebody, whether he just pulls his hand away and we die naturally, or he says the Canaanites must die, is that murder for God?
No.
No, because he's the creator. He can resurrect life, right? So it's not murder for God. It's judgment. God gets to decide when we die because he's the creator and he's the only one that can resurrect us. So I always ask people when you say find the Canaanite situation in the Bible, does God just wake up like some sort of cosmic mafia boss and say, Canaanites, I want them dead? No. He's given them 400 years of warning, and when they continue to do these evil practices, such as sacrificing their children to Molech, he finally tells the Israelites, you need to drive these people out of the land. And so he does do that. He drives them out of the land. Many of them are killed. Many of them just ran away. Okay, that's judgment. That's not murder. In fact, if Christianity is true, people don't really die. They just change location. They just go from this location to the eternal location, and it's up to God when that happens. Whether it's 2 years old or 82 years old, that's up to him. So, no, God has the authority to do that. And I would ask people, because I had this happen recently, where a young woman got up there and said, you know, I just can't believe in the God of the Old Testament. He would kill people, and I went through all this, and I finally asked her. I said, well, where are you on the abortion issue? And she said, oh, I'm pro-choice. And I said, well, let me ask you this. Why is it that when God plays God in the Old Testament, he decides who lives and dies, he's immoral. But when you play God here on earth and you decide who lives and dies through abortion, that's somehow your moral right. I mean, why is it that we have the right to kill people but God doesn't? It's basically the question. So I find people who make these arguments very inconsistent. I would ask, what moral standard are you using? And by the way, that's another question you could ask too, is by what moral standard are any of these atrocities if there's no God? Right?
Wow, yeah. And then I have another question. How do you deal with the problem of like natural evil, so like natural disasters?
Okay. Well, the question is where to, first of all, a question like that assumes that people are valuable, right?
Yeah.
And that people ought not die young. Is that necessarily true?
I would say so.
That ought not die young.
Oh, no.
We don't want them to die young, but some
right,
people
yeah,
do.
Yeah,
we live
yeah.
in a fallen world. The natural disasters go back to a fallen world, just like moral issues. You know, there are two kinds of evil. There's the kind of evil people do to one another, and there's the kind of evil that occurs to us just through natural disasters. And what I would say is that natural disasters do occur. We don't always know why they occur, and that's why Jesus used both a natural disaster in Luke 13 and a moral person, an immoral person doing evil to somebody else, Pilate, in that to say, look, these people didn't die because they're worse sinners than you, but unless you repent, these same things will happen to you. So I would talk about the fact that we live in a fallen world, and I would also say this, that if you notice the kinds of miracles that Jesus does, they're in four categories. He's sinless. That's one of our problems, right? He has power over nature. That's another problem. Nature can kill us. Earthquakes, hurricanes, tsunamis. He has power over sickness. He heals people. And he has power over death. He raises people from the dead. Those are the four things that make this a fallen world. Sin, nature, sickness, and death. And Jesus comes along and he says, I can fix all of those things. I'm the Messiah. And so he does. Now, we still live in this fallen world because God is waiting for the full number of Gentiles to come in before he comes back and takes us all into eternity. But Jesus isn't doing random miracles. He's doing miracles in those four categories to say, I'm the one that can fix what's wrong with this world. He's the Messiah, the Savior.
Thank you.
All right, thanks. Mm-hmm. By the way, a book that you want to get on some of these Old Testament atrocities and that kind of thing is Paul Copan's book, Is God a Moral Monster? Check it out.
Okay, thank
all
you.
Right, thank you. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Hey, I'm EJ, and I happen to be a big fan of you, and I'm also a big fan of God. I'm a
good
Christian. And
and yeah. you got your Bengal colors on right there, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Very sharp.
So I think I have three questions. The first question is, if everybody's worth saving, then what's up with, what's his name, Satan, right? What's the need for hell if, you know, God, the God of mercy can, you know, forgive Satan?
Well, if Satan doesn't want to be forgiven, if Satan doesn't want to be in heaven, then God is not going to force him into heaven against his will.
So hell shows that man is free and God is love. Why? Because God is not going to force people into his presence against their will, and he's going to separate himself from them. And that's why ultimate reality is going to be two places, heaven with God, hell separated from God. But love requires free will, and God can't force anyone to love him because then they wouldn't have free will. Forced love is not love, it's a contradiction. So he has to give us all the free will to love him, but that also gives us the freedom to reject him as well.
And then speaking of free will, if God gave us this thing called free will, and he happens to be omniscient, or he knows everything, and there's this thing called destiny, is there really free will?
Yes, because just because God knows what's going to happen doesn't mean that he's forcing you to do it. Let me give you an example of this. Let's suppose a young woman has a new baby, and she puts the baby down to sleep one night, and she knows at some point during the night that baby's going to wake up and want to eat, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but because she knows that, does that mean she's forcing the baby to wake up? No. Knowledge does not imply causation. God knows what we're going to do because he's outside of time and he's all-knowing, but that doesn't mean he's forcing us to do those things.
But you did say that as a Christian, it's always good to submit your personal mission to
yes.
the mission of God.
Yes.
Isn't your personal mission synonymous with free will?
Yes, you can choose to submit your personal mission to God's mission, or you can decide to go your own way. And that's what a lot of people do. And even Christians, we do. We don't follow God perfectly. Of course we don't. That's why we need a Savior.
And then I got the last question. In the Quran, Abraham is mentioned as Ibrahim, and Jacob is mentioned as Yakubu, and there were a whole lot of people mentioned. Jesus, for example, is mentioned as, I think, Isa. I don't
know. Isa, yeah, yeah, you're right, yeah.
So if that is so, and we have some biblical characters in the Quran, why can't we consider the Islamic God to be the Christian God?
Because the Islamic God is strictly monotheistic, whereas the Christian God is triune. And if you ask a Muslim scholar and a Christian scholar, are they the same God? They will both say no, for that very reason. One of the greatest sins in Islam is called shirk, that's putting partners with God, and Muslims think you're somehow putting a partner with God if you believe in a Trinity. But I think the Trinity solves problems, it doesn't create them. Because without a Trinity, how do you have eternal love? If there's just God and no one to love in a strictly monotheistic being, you don't have love. But if you have a lover, a loved one, and a spirit of love, you can have love for all eternity in a Trinity.
All right. Thank you, sir.
All right, thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi.
What's your name?
I'm Katie.
Say again?
Katie.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Katie. Get a little closer, if you would, to that mic.
All right,
okay. Go ahead. Yeah.
So I have a friend who is a Muslim, and we debate occasionally, and he came up with this question that I haven't been able to come up with a sufficient answer for. Basically, it's the argument that, how do you respond to the Islamic belief that Jesus can't be God because God can't die?
Okay, let's deal with the Trinity for a second, because that's really the answer to it. Because the Trinity, as I mentioned before, is actually solves the problem rather than creates a problem. Mm-hmm. Think of, and there's no perfect illustration of the Trinity, but I think this is the best we can do, right? Think of one triangle, one divine nature, and there's three corners to that triangle, right? You have a Father, a Son, and a Holy Spirit. This is one being with three persons in it. But the Son, Jesus, has a human nature that doesn't intermingle with the divine nature, but the Son, this one person, has two natures. He has a divine nature and a human nature. So when Jesus died on the cross, which nature died?
The human.
Just the human nature. God didn't die. Jesus' human nature died. And the only way that you can bridge a gap between God and man is to have a being that is perfect on both sides of that gap. So Jesus is a perfect human nature. He doesn't sin. He's never sinned. And he also has a divine nature, so he can bring the two together. And so whenever you ask a question about Jesus, you always have to ask two questions. Did Jesus die? As man, yes. As God, no. Did Jesus get hungry? As man, yes. As God, no. Did Jesus know all things? As God, yes. As man, no. Right? You always have to ask two questions about Jesus because he's got two natures. You could also look at it this way, that the Trinity is one what with three who's. You got who one, the Father, who two, the Son, and who three, the Holy Spirit. But who two, the Son, has
two whats. He's got what one, the divine nature, and what two, the human nature. So whenever you're talking about who two, you got to ask which what are you talking about? You're talking about what one or what two? See, this is the Abbott and Costello theology we have here, okay? So
basically his human nature died, God nature
technically. Yes, God's
died.
Nature did not die.
Okay.
So you could say, it's a good question, but since Jesus has two natures, he doesn't die. Now, you could use even an analogy from a movie. Have you seen the movie Avatar?
Yeah.
Okay.
No.
Well, okay, well, it's a popular movie. In this movie, there's this guy who's in a wheelchair, and they put him in this machine, and they put him in this machine in this space village, outside of the spaceship, he turns into an avatar, a creature outside. So he's one person with two natures. He's got a human nature inside the spaceship and an avatar nature outside the spaceship. And, I mean, that's just a fictional version, really, of one person with two natures.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you.
Thanks, Katie. Hey, it's Peter again.
Hello again.
All right, last question with Peter. All right, second to last question. Oh, we have a Buckeye with us. Look at that. We got to go. Sorry, Peter. Let's talk privately. I'll be back at the book table if anybody wants to talk briefly. Sorry, we got to go. Thank you all for being here.